And welcome to the 23rd meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have one public item on the agenda today, which is to take evidence on the sustainability of Scotland's finances from two panels of witnesses as part of our pre-budget scrutiny this year. For the first panel, I welcome to the meeting Jarwi Souza, Deputy Director, Fraser Valenden Institute, Professor David Heald, Emeritus Professor and Honorary Senior Research Fellow, Adam Smith Business School, University of Glasgow, and Professor David Bell, Professor of Economics, University of Stirling. I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session, and if witnesses want to be brought into discussion on a question that I've asked to any specific witness, please indicate to clerks and I can then call you. So we have your excellent submissions, so I'm going to go straight to questions. And I think the first question is to you, Zhao, which is basically with regard to what you talk about in your submission with regard to realistic assumptions. So what you've said is, the medium-term financial strategy highlighted a large funding gap of £1 billion in 24-25 and close to £2 billion by 27-28. The 24-25 and future budgets will need to include realistic assumptions on spending commitments, given the available level of funding, and be clear about prioritisation decisions as well as realistic policy on tax. So what do you consider to be realistic?
So I think the thing that I highlighted here is that given the constraints of the fiscal framework that the Scottish Government must operate under, it cannot run a gap or have a gap in funding for as large as it has currently planned. So there will have to be these discussions about and decisions made about whether there will be increases in tax, reductions in spending, prioritisation across different levels different programmes. There are clearly, it will be possible to raise revenues should the Scottish Government wish to do so, but there are limitations to how much revenue you can raise. For example, I think we highlighted that there was a proposal to raise income tax by introducing a new band between the higher rate and the additional rate, or the top rate, and by 2p, I mean, that would only go a limited amount towards filling the gap that is currently being forecast. It's worth saying that the gap that was projected in the medium-term financial strategy is likely lower now, because the income tax reconciliation has come in lower than the Scottish Fiscal Commission had anticipated at that time. And also in the fiscal framework review, the Scottish Government has got more borrowing powers for day-to-day spending than it did before. But the other thing that I think we wanted to highlight is that there was some talk about filling some of the gap with things like wealth taxes, but introducing new taxes is not only challenging in terms of the devolution framework. The actual process of introducing a new tax is quite long. It requires time spent in designing a tax, consulting on its implementation, actually preparing the implementation and collection mechanisms. And so the Scottish Government's financing position in 24-25 is unlikely to be helped by introducing a new tax, because it's highly unlikely that all of that would be able to be done by the time the new financial year rolls around.
Okay, thank you very much for that. That's actually very helpful. You've touched on one of the things I was wanting to move on to next, which was wealth taxes. We are going to be in a roundtable meeting just straight after this one, taking evidence and a number of the witnesses there. And we will be obviously speaking to them about this. I've suggested quite substantial sums of money can be raised over a relatively short time by wealth taxes. For example, for if not the current financial year, then financial year 25-26. What would your view be of that?
I think it's the creation of a wealth tax would require careful consideration about what to levy it on, how to institute the collection mechanism, what kind of assessment there would be. Would it be assessed like like property taxes are at the moment, or would it be self-assessed? All of that takes a long time to implement. When you think about how long it has taken, it takes HMRC or Revenue Scotland to introduce a new tax and get all the collection mechanisms in process and all of that. It is actually quite hard. If you remember when the UK government tried to implement the health and social care levy, it actually had to implement it as a national insurance levy first, and it never did come into place. But when it was meant to come into place, it was to be collected through national insurance because it took such a long time to get the health and social care levy in the system. And it would be a question of whether, if it were to be Revenue Scotland to implement that, would they have the budget already at the moment for that to be implemented? So I think it's unlikely that you could raise substantial amounts of revenue immediately, because the administrative processes just take a long time for it to be put in place.
Okay, Professor Heald, what you've said that you is that you don't accept that the Scottish Government has prioritised economic growth or demonstrated a strategic approach to tax. So, I mean, given the kind of your expertise in this area, what do you think it should or could do differently?
Well, while I was waiting to come into the room, I was given a copy of a diagram that I'd prepared.
Thrusting economist.
Yeah. I'd prepared. I've for a very long time been an advocate of taxes. That goes back to the 1970s. But I think that the UK tax system is a total mess, and the Scottish Parliament has made the tax system in Scotland worse. We have a nonsensical position whereby we have a big peak at the higher rate threshold, because the differential higher rate threshold in Scotland and the rest of the UK. We've got the fact that the national insurance threshold operates from the UK level and not the Scottish level. So people are paying the people in Scotland are paying the higher rate of national insurance, whereas in England they've gone to the 2% rate. We then have the strange position that an emergency measure by Alistair Darling, when he started the withdrawal of personal allowances at 100,000, which still remains 100,000, produces another peak. So we've got two peaks in the marginal rate threshold to do with national insurance on one level and the withdrawal of personal allowance. That's complicated, as the diagram we're talking about also makes the point, that whereas income tax is actually done on a separate taxation, there was a major issue, I think it was the 1980s, about whether people who were married would be taxed separately or independently. So we've got a position whereby the tax system operates on individuals, but the benefit system operates on households. So we've got a strange position whereby a household with one income can very quickly hit the child benefit withdrawal, whereas a household with two incomes could have a much larger combined income, but not get it.
So this is a scenario, a UK scenario, actually, whereby someone on £51,000 a year will lose child benefit, but if there are two people who earn £49,000 a year, they will continue to get the child benefit.
Well, they don't completely lose child, but there's a phased withdrawal.
Well, yes,
but they hit the phased withdrawal.
They start losing
period.
It at £50,000.
And that's why you get the peak, because eventually you've lost all the child benefit, and eventually you've lost all the personal allowance. That is not strategic. I mean, the Scottish Parliament is constrained by what the UK government does, but we haven't been agile in terms of trying to make the system work. A very important technical point is that in terms of incentives, it's the marginal rates that matter. We're going to get into a position whereby NHS consultants and senior scientists are going to start negotiating with their employers for net pay, just the way that footballers and football managers already do. So I think we have to be very careful. A rule of thumb I noticed some time ago is that about 5% of Scottish income taxpayers income taxpayers in Scotland, because it's not all going to the Scottish Government. 5% of income taxpayers in Scotland contribute 40% of income tax revenues. And that's the figures in the HMRC published data. So I think we have to be very careful how we treat that group. Because if we teach public sector professionals about tax avoidance, we've got a serious problem.
Yeah, I mean, the reason I'm kind of labouring this whole point a wee bit, I suppose, well, I've only asked two or three questions so far, but I mean, the answers have been excellent and very interesting. They lead to so many other questions. Is because there is so much pressure on the Scottish Government to increase taxation. I think the Poverty Alliance, who we're speaking to is later, for example, a coalition of many, many organisations have all talked about increasing benefits, all the wealth taxes, putting up the higher rate of tax, putting up the taxes at the upper rate, etc. So what do you feel the impact of that will be on A, economic growth, behavioural change, and B, economic growth, Professor Yield?
To try and unpack your question, I think that at the time of the Smith Commission, there was a broad cross-party consensus about having some social security benefits devolved. But we've now got to the position whereby the Scottish Fiscal Commission thinks by 2027-28 that the Scottish social security benefits are going to cost 1.4 billion more than the Scottish Government gets in block grant, in positive block grant adjustment. Now, the problem about that is that means that within the largely fixed budget, the Scottish Government has to divert money from core public services such as health, education and local government. And local government's very clearly facing a very serious crisis now, to pay for these better what the Northern Irish would call super parity spending, and I really worry about that, because I think that people are trying to help by progressive taxation policies are actually the very people who depend on public services more. People on lower incomes have got less option of using private sector services if the public services are not working. So I think there's a very serious issue. There's also a technical point, which is really important, which is that in England, social security spend is annually managed expenditure. It's recognised that you can't necessarily predict it very well. So basically the Treasury covers, providing once the benefit level is set and agreed, the Treasury covers any underspend. In Scotland, because of the way the system works, it becomes part of the Scottish budget as a part of DEL. So it makes the Scottish budget much more difficult to manage. I think that one has to, that the issue for Scotland is that the issue for the UK is the UK is not fiscally sustainable. We cannot afford the present package of public services at the present package of taxes. So something has to give. Scotland's got the same problem because it's locked in to the UK policies anyway, and that's going to affect what comes down the pipeline. We know there's a problem because there are big demographic drivers behind the OBR forecasts and the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecasts, but there's actually paralysis about saying one can either try and do something now, or you can wait for the cliff edge, where you get a complete panic. Going back to your point about economic growth, I think that I do not regard industrial subsidies as necessarily the way to improve economic growth. What the Scottish Government has got to do is to make public services work better and make the infrastructure work better. And one of the issues that is common to the evidence is the lack of multi-year budgeting, which is something which, to some extent, is outside the Scottish Government's control, but a very serious problem. And the question of that whenever the UK has a problem with the public finances, it cuts capital. And because there's separate control of capital DEL and resource DEL, that passes through to the Scottish, through the Scottish Government. And that's one of the reasons why the UK is actually bad at delivering infrastructure. Because if you want successful private sector delivery of the capital investment of infrastructure, you actually, the private firms need a reasonably steady flow of work. When you get this erratic jumping and collapse of capital expenditure, it actually just basically, you lose capacity. There's another problem, which is it also affects local government and health in the public sector, because the clients lose the capacity to be an intelligent client in terms of capital expenditure. So we, without enumerating the various disasters...
Actually going to ask you about capital expenditure, I have to say. I don't like to interrupt in free flow, but the point I also asked was about behavioural change. So, for example, if the Scottish Government decided, you know what, politically it's going to be very difficult for us to cut spending, whatever it happens to be, we're just going to have to hit that 1% or 2% of the highest taxpayers, what would be the impact on that? Or even what would be the impact on people who, you talked about the, you know, people who are just over the marginal higher rate threshold, so what would be the impact on that?
It's difficult to know what the behavioural effects would be. What I would point you to is the Scottish Fiscal Commission. The Scottish Fiscal Commission for 23-24, that's the first year of the changes, it reckons that the static costing of decreasing the top rate threshold to 125,000, the static costing, i.e. nobody behaves any differently, is you gain 33 million. The behavioural costing is you gain 8 million. In terms of the top rate going to 47%, the static costing is 32 million. The behavioural costing is 3 million. You lose 90% of the revenue. I've read the evidence, been submitted to the committee. I do not think there's any easy sources for higher tax. If you want to get more income tax in, you've basically got to hit the basic rate. There is not much more scope. Now, we will find out in due course whether the Scottish Fiscal Commission is being too pessimistic, but of course that's what determines what's available to spend because of the way that the fiscal framework works.
OK, now, Professor Bell, you've been very patient. I know that JL wants to come back in as well, and I mean, I want to be able to give my colleagues an opportunity, and I'm a bit miffed the fact that I'm only about 3 or 4 questions into the 25 I wrote down here that I was going to ask you before we actually started. But one of the things that you actually talked about, actually, Professor Bell, was you said that the outlook remains difficult with funding for day-to-day non-benefit spending set to be almost 2% lower in 27-28 than in 22-23. This is despite forecasts for a significant increase in net revenues from Scotland's devolved income tax revenues over the next few years. If this did not materialise, the reduction would be closer to 5% over the same period. So I'm just wondering if you can talk to that and possibly talk about, because we did talk about tax, but how you feel the Scottish Government could adjust its taxation policies to be more strategic, as Professor Hill put it.
Presents the sort of strategic approach. One thing that was occurring to me there was, overall, do you really want to tax work? If, for example, one of your really top strategies is to get to net zero, why aren't you taxing carbon? That's a general point that one might make if you were thinking about a strategic approach to taxation. We are where we are, though, and as both witnesses have said, the UK system is a mess, and Scotland has added to that mess. It seems to me that there is further potential in confusing things insofar as, for example, the introduction of a wealth tax, I think, would take a lot of time, would probably require cooperation with the UK government, because a large part of people's wealth holding will be financial assets, and where these are held, will presumably matter as far as the way that they're going to be taxed is concerned.
Be impacted by the Internal Market Act?
It might be that that's an interesting possibility, but I would have thought that there would also be informational requirements on HMRC, which are not currently in place, that might have to be put in place, and that might require the UK government to go along with that. So I imagine that would create a difficulty. When we were talking about the length of time to implement a wealth tax, what crossed my mind was, well, it took us about 6 years to implement social security in Scotland. It was very, very complex, the social security measures that we've introduced. A wealth tax is not a simple tax. In most countries, there is a lot of avoidance. The only place where it seems to work, in my understanding, is Switzerland. But other places, it's largely regarded as not a very significant potential source of revenue. And then coming back to economic growth, I mean, one of the things you have to bear in mind is that if Scotland does end up with higher tax rates than other parts of the UK, then that will be seized upon by those other parts of the UK. When there's inward investment, then when there's potential inward investment, attempting to ensure that inward investment doesn't come to Scotland but goes to wherever their region might happen to be. Whether these taxes are in themselves significant and would ultimately deter people once they were here is another matter. But in a sense, it's the impression given actually also matters quite a lot. Not only the tax rates in themselves.
Because the message that's been sent, I mean, what you've said actually in your submission is that tax increases are likely to be unpopular and possibly counterproductive, and funding reductions to other spending priorities are likely to be valued more by the electorate than the gains resulting from the introduction of the new policy, so-called loss aversion, which I find quite interesting. I mean, I've talked about this a number of times at this committee in terms of, you know, council tax reform, the people who will gain will just shrug their shoulders, but the people who actually lose will be less than chuffed. And in fact, the consultation on council tax, which closes tomorrow, I've not had anyone contact me to say this is great, but I've had plenty of people say they're not too chuffed about it. So I wonder if you can just talk about that, and then I'll let Jill in.
So, I mean, this is the danger of entering into commitments which have medium-term or long-term implications and not then feeling it possible to stop these commitments because of the danger in terms of how bad the associated publicity once something stops being funded is. So we've sort of drifted into a position where some what we would call key parts of our public sector systems, such as local government, have sort of not really. Well, what has happened has not been significantly noticed by those setting the budget. But we've now got into a situation where local government is pretty much in severe difficulty, and other programmes have started. And have continued to grow. And of course, as I point out in my paper, health is one of those that has been growing consistently over the piece. But you end up in a situation where there are constantly additional demands for cash and a requirement to continue with those programmes that are already started, and unless there's some clear strategy, you end up and an understanding that funding that starts doesn't always continue forever. Unless you have that kind of understanding, you end up with this loss aversion, people being deeply unhappy about the fact that their particular spending programme has been stopped, when everyone thinks that such programmes are the most important things since sliced bread.
And that loss aversion makes governments nervous about making radical change.
Yep.
Jean?
I was just going to come back to what Professor Hild was talking about, behavioural change, and just to make the point that there is something that the Scottish Government has to take into account, which is the fact that income tax in Scotland, or Scottish income tax, is not the same thing as income tax in Scotland, and therefore, because it's only on non-saving, non-dividend income, at higher levels of income, you're more likely to have people who can change the way they get paid. And so if you change the, and the graph that we were talking about only takes into account labour income, but if you can pay yourself in dividends, for example, then your calculation between the marginal rate that you pay at different levels of income could be very different. And you could end up in a position where if you hike the rate a lot for people who can shift the way they get paid, then you could end up in a situation where more income goes towards the UK government and not to the Scottish government.
Now, I've got a few other things I would like to ask, but I want to let colleagues in, so I'm just going to ask one more question, which is about transparency, because we haven't touched on that. And, Jarl, I'll stick with you, because you've said in your response that a more forthcoming approach from the Scottish Government to the publication of financial memorandum for the committee scrutiny would be an improvement. So I'm just wondering if you can touch on that, because clearly that impacts directly on the work of this committee.
Yeah, I just think it's really important for these to be presented in good time and in due course, and to I know that the committee has had some back and forth with ministers about being able to access them. I just think it's really important for everyone to know the consequences of legislation when they come out and when they're announced as well. So one thing that I think works generally really well is when if you announce something, you present a costing with it and don't wait until legislation is being passed, because that's not necessarily the same thing.
Okay, thanks. And Professor Hield, what you've basically said is that budget documentation should set out clearly the additional cost of above parity expenditure and reduced costs from below parity expenditure. So can you touch on that?
That comes back to my earlier point that given the very constrained total budget, if Scotland has services or things that it provides which is not provided in England, there's no Barnett consequences funding that. And that means that, and the same point I've already made about social security spend, the problem is that reduces the amount of funding available for core public services. So that it's not, people think that Scotland, because the Scottish public are getting benefits from the Scottish government that the English public don't get. That's true, but the point is those extra benefits, whether it's social security benefits or free university tuition, are being funded out of money that might otherwise have been used for local government health and education. And that's what seriously worries me. And there's also a technical point that on the social security spend, it's very difficult politically for Scotland to be less generous than the English. And so that every time that Scotland has a power over social security, there will be pressure for Scotland to show how much more generous it is. But that further erodes the funding that's available for core public services. And to come back to a point the Chair has made about the council tax consultation, that consultation is looking to raise another £176 million before any compensation for low-income households in highly rated properties or for councils that don't get any more money. It is ludicrous that, given the fact it's fully devolved, that we're still using 1991 house prices as the basis for council tax. I'm strongly in favour of a residential property tax, but one is discrediting that the principle that it's a useful mechanism for funding local government. By using 1991 values, it just brings the system into total disrepute. And if I lived in Ardrossan, I would be somewhat upset that the relative house prices in Ardrossan and the west of Scotland generally have gone down relative to the east of Scotland. The Institute for Fiscal Studies has actually done a study in England, and it reckons that 50% of English properties are in the wrong council tax band. It cannot do that work for Scotland because of data availability problems. And I think that is something which I think it would be very beneficial if the committee could look into why it's not possible to replicate that work for Scotland. So if people are in the wrong band, some people will be in too high bands, some people in too low bands, compared with if you did it on current values, that discredits the system. So my personal view is I'm in favour of a revaluation. I would be in favour of thinking about what the multiplier should be between the band D and the higher band, but you cannot sensibly do that on the basis of antique valuations.
Yeah, I mean, I think it goes back to a loss aversion, to be perfectly honest with you, and whatever the Scottish Government would do on that will be attacked from all sides. So I think that's maybe why they, and indeed the predecessors, and indeed the government south of the border are not exactly running to actually change this. But to go back to...
But it's worrying.
Of course it is.
It's worrying that we wanted a Scottish Parliament, and this is a core part of devolved functions, and if we can't actually manage our own set... a tax system that's long been run in Scotland. It was run by the Scottish Office before devolution. If we can't run the local tax system properly, it doesn't give any great credibility to Scotland asking for more tax powers.
I think it's about the government's survivability if they were to implement this across the board, given the ferocious onslaught that would come from all sides. I mean, it's just a political reality. The economic reality is different, in my view, from the political reality. I think we would all agree with it. With the economic reality. Now, just the last one on transparency, David, which is regard to mitigations. Now, the Scottish Government mitigate a lot of UK taxes, and in fact, some of the witnesses that are to follow this session are saying we should suggest yet more UK, areas where the UK government has, for example, reduced expenditure, or where they feel more expenditure should be given. So what transparency do you think, what do you think we should do to make the mitigation is more transparent?
By mitigations, do you mean...
I was asking Professor Bell. Oh,
can I ask the same question?
David, and you're both called David, I forgot. Apologies, there's always a plethora of Davids in the economics world.
Sorry, and can I ask the same question David was going to ask? What exactly did you mean by mitigation?
So for example, the obvious one is what they call the additional room supplement, the bedroom tax. So, for example, the Scottish Government actually has been mitigating that for years, but I don't see much transparency in terms of that. So that's just one thing that it's mitigating. So, for example, what should it do to try and... To make that more transparent in terms of the budget?
Well, I mean, David Hill's absolutely right. These changes in support for people on lower incomes a strong case can be made that they are justified, but there is necessarily a cost, and that cost should be made clear in the budget in the budget documents in government in all government communications, and it seems to me that we need to understand broadly the shares of spending that are going to key areas like health, like education, like social security, and also what share is going to capital spending. And it's not clear to me that kind of message and the trajectories that these shares have been and will take in the future are clear both to Parliament and to Scottish society more generally. It did come as quite a shock to me to note that on current trends, health will be more than half the budget in a relatively short period of time. So, you know, that sort of information, you know, even if people aren't into the weeds of public spending, those generalities in terms of where our main spending areas are moving seem to me the sort of thing that needs to be got across very, very transparently.
OK. Let's open out the session. First person to ask questions will be John, followed by Liz.
Thanks very much, convener. Something we haven't really mentioned so far is the fiscal framework and the fact that it was agreed very rapidly and somewhat to the committee's surprise, because we'd expected a long, drawn-out battle. Was it agreed too hastily, Professor Bell?
I've got to say, it came as a surprise to me that the day our report was published, we were told that the framework had been agreed. We did expect some much longer discussion. Clearly, discussion had gone on in the background. Our report had been held back for 5 months after it had been completed. And then all of a sudden, all of the announcements came out together. It's an incredibly complex area, and as you know, if you're not called David, you can't understand it. The outcome that we got in terms of which mechanism was selected for setting the BGAs is probably as good an outcome as Scotland could have hoped for. On borrowing powers, perhaps there have been some increase in borrowing powers, but not massively so. And I suspect that at the background, this was the trade-off that was being argued about between the Scottish Government on the one hand and the Treasury on the other. And so we are where we are. As I point out in my paper, we could be quite considerably worse off going forward.
Yes, I noted that in your paper, that the index per capita method is better than the comparable model. But are we not still left competing with England? And specifically, are we not still competing with London and the southeast of England, which kind of dominates the English economy? And therefore, are we not permanently at a disadvantage?
Well, so the sort of rules of engagement as far as the report was concerned were really around that we took the current broad structure as given and then argued between the comparable method and the index per capita method. We didn't look at the option, say, of going down the Welsh route. And so it is true that we will continually being, well, for most of the BGAs, it's England and either tax revenues in England or social security spending in England that will matter, and it's England as a whole. So, one can go sort of very fine-grained about what risks it's appropriate to run or not. And there's no manual that you can go to and say, well, this is how it should be. But what you're saying is correct. And the way the framework has been reformulated actually does not significantly change anything very much. So that broad framework, that the comparator is England, is going to continue.
OK. Mr. Souza, do you want to come in on that one?
I think that, was it... It definitely, like, the fact that there is a... that the block rate adjustments are linked to England, including London, obviously, like, the weight that London has on the economy... It's significant, but it's difficult to think what could very easily be done otherwise without changing the whole of the framework significantly.
Okay, Professor Heald.
My personal view was that keeping the per capita index method was absolutely crucial. So that's a success. I would like to have seen more borrowing powers, both for capital and for resource. But I can see that there was a trade-off. I mean, the Treasurer refused, when the fiscal framework was originally introduced, to accept the fact that the fallback method was the index method. So that is actually a positive gain, that is now the established method.
Okay, thank you. I mean, we've heard from various places that we need a better public understanding of how budgets work, and longer term, should we, you know, have more taxes and more spend, or less taxes and less spend? And we get the impression that other countries, and correct me if I'm wrong, you know, like maybe in the Nordic countries, there's a kind of public debate on this and a public agreement that they want higher taxes and they want better public services. Do you think it's possible to have that debate in this country, either Scotland or the UK? Professor Bell?
If you recall, we did have a citizens' assembly way back in pre-COVID times. I remember David Phillips and I spoke at that. And that was actually a mechanism which seemed to me to lead to a better, at least among the members of the assembly, a better understanding of the way that the finances work, and as I've implied, and the other members of the panel have implied, it's incredibly complex, but there are some general principles that I think that can be got across. I think on one to one with citizens, it's possible to convey the key messages, but when filtered through the media, I think it's the kinds of discussion that we're currently having is just generally not going to make the headlines, not going to make them sell more papers or get more views.
Okay, that's very pessimistic, Mr. Souza.
I'd like to be a bit more optimistic. I know that whenever you poll the general public on whether they want more or less tax, they say less tax. And whether they want more or less spending, they want more spending. But reality is, like, there is a possibility of having a conversation. But this kind of relates back to the medium and longer term budgeting that we're advocating for, which is the fact that if you have a coherent strategy, not everything that is in a budget has to be popular individually for it to be understood by the public. And so having a coherent strategy and a direction of travel that can be explained and that can be put into plans that then allow public services to plan ahead, that goes some way towards addressing the concerns that they may have about, you know, being able to have that conversation.
I mean, the idea of longer term and multi-year budgeting, do you think that's possible under the present fiscal framework, where we don't know year by year what we're going to get?
I think it's necessary to have some sort of medium-term plan, even if that funding is not completely set in stone, because you have to have a baseline from which you then compare what you eventually want your policies to be. And so I think it's really important to have some holding assumptions, even if they're not the final ones, because that, I think, gives you a direction of travel, which then allows you to make decisions as to whether you think things should go towards more spending, more less spending, more tax, less tax, etc.
Okay. Professor Heald, I don't know if you want to comment on that. And also, does the Scottish Government have too many priorities? That's been suggested to us.
Yeah, I mean, most governments have got too many priorities because nobody likes saying that something isn't a priority. One of the fundamental problems is that the UK spending review, the basic way the spending review developed after 1998 was that a government would get elected and it would set a 4 or 5 year spending review covering, you know, 3, 4, 5 years. Various events like Brexit, COVID, cost of living crisis, political instability at Westminster has actually destroyed that system. So it's become a one-year budgeting system, even if we call it a spending review. So we've got a problem at the UK level, which then transmits down to the Scottish Government level, which then transmits down to local government, which then transmits down to voluntary organisations, some of which have given evidence to this committee, in terms of, you know, one-year funding. And if you want to improve the efficiency of the way that public spending works, actually getting back to a multi-year system would actually make a vast improvement. The trouble is, it's quite difficult to see in the present climate because of the political instability. It's very difficult to see how you get that back at the UK level. So without some stability at the UK level, it's not going to be possible to have stability at the Scottish Government, local authorities, or charities. You can very much improve the efficiency of spending, of revenue spending, if you have kind of medium term planning. You also won't make such a mess of capital projects as well, because one of the points I made earlier is it's not just the provision of services. It's the fact that the public sector clients have to have project management capacity. And the private firms have got to know there's a steady flow of work. And if there isn't, that's what I think one of the reasons why the UK is so bad at infrastructure spend.
OK, thank you. I'm assuming we're not getting 34 minutes each, so I shall finish there.
When you're convener. Liz to be followed by Ross.
Thank you. Can I ask about both UK tax and global tax debates? Because in the first instance with UK, there's a huge issue about the UK tax structure being far too complex, far too many loopholes, not delivering on the revenue that it should be. People are avoiding tax too much, big debate about inheritance tax. And on the global scene, there are a lot of debates about whether we should be moving more towards environmental taxation and to try to stop some of the big multinationals depositing their money in safe havens, etc. Now, these are all very academic debates, taking up lots of column space in The Economist, Financial Times, The Spectator, New Statesman, all these publications. But to what extent does a government in Scotland have to try to second-guess what's going to happen there? Because technically, they could be quite important changes in the future.
My advice to the committee and to the government would be to manage what we've got better. That's the first point. The other thing that the devolved administrations can do is actually to represent such arguments to the UK government. I mean, clearly the UK is a minor player. Scotland's not even a player in terms of the OECD type initiatives about corporate taxation. One has to be very careful. There's been a very serious loss of trust in politics and in democracy. And it's very, very, very important that the tax system is seen to apply to everybody. And one should be very concerned. It's not just the revenue losses that some tax has been seen as essentially voluntary for people with certain income and certain wealth. It actually damages the tax compliance of other people in the economy. So I think what the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament should concentrate on is managing the taxes that we've got better. As I said at the very beginning of my evidence, I think we haven't got a strategic approach to tax. Marginal rates matter for incentives. Average rates matter for progressivity, and just you don't make the system more progressive if you actually just put up marginal rates at the high end. If you don't think about what the longer term consequences are, and in fact, the Scottish Fiscal Commission thinks these consequences come actually very quickly.
So, can I just ask on that before I come to the two others? What do you think the strategic objective should be in relation to tax if we are going to create more economic growth?
I think getting away from the idea there are easy places to get more tax revenue. I think you could get a much more sensible structure of more sensible structure of income tax. So I would. So the income tax schedule. We should be thinking seriously about this problem. Some people may think that 44,000 makes people rich. I don't think 44,000 makes people rich. I think that the for a country that's worried about its demographic profile, the child benefit withdrawal policy, which is a UK policy, seems totally counterproductive. Totally counterproductive. And I think in terms of economic growth, it's a question of public services working well and infrastructure working well and actually having an economy that the people who we've expensively educated actually want to stay in Scotland. So we want to be a high wage economy, because the high wage economy has got benefits in terms of private consumption for those individuals, but also the tax revenues they pay into the Scottish budget.
Professor Bell, do you have any thoughts about the sort of global and UK tax structures that would have an impact on what we do in Scotland?
So I would echo what David has just said around the, in terms of the long-term future of the Scottish economy, it's essential that we retain as many skilled, well-educated workers in Scotland as possible. People are most mobile in their early 20s. They make decisions that affect their lifetime at that point. So having opportunities for such young people seems to me to be an essential part of enhancing the growth of the economy. And so what that also means is probably making things like startups much easier, supporting startups. That's where the public sector can maybe play a role in de-risking to some extent. We are not going to become Silicon Valley, but there are areas where Scotland can help develop. But also there's a question about the relationship with the private sector and ensuring that there's confidence in the private sector to invest and to grow their own operations within Scotland. And political instability does not help if that's the case. Political instability manifested in the sense of not really being sure what's going to happen next year in terms of tax rates or whatever support people might get. On the global thing, I've already mentioned that there are arguments now that if you're taking a very strategic approach, what you should be thinking about is taxing carbon rather than people's work. That is tough. That is a really, really tough thing to do, because it has big distributional consequences. It's much less progressive than income tax. So rural community, if you start taxing, say, road use, rural communities would be hit hard. I do make the point in my paper that fuel duties are going to fall over the next few years, and that's going to create a huge hole in the UK government budget. And how is that going to be filled? So, we need some strategic thinking on that front. So I'm happy to discuss further on the carbon taxation, but one thing that I would add to what David has said and which further throws confusion into the taxation of individual work is the national insurance system, which further complicates the marginal rates that individuals face, and of course of which there is no control in Scotland.
And I'm just interested in this because, I mean, I hear what you're saying about the fact that we should do a lot better with what we already have. I just feel that in the context of us obviously being part of the United Kingdom and a global community, we have to be careful that our strategic objectives are in line with what is coming down the line in UK taxation and in global taxation, because if we go off at a different tangent and suddenly find something slightly conflicts with that, we've got a problem. And it's just, it's a very complex area, I know, but it's just trying to get a grip on that.
Yeah, but it's true that where you've got differential tax rates between jurisdictions, you are going to set up incentives that are going to cause some factor of one of the capital or labour to move. You know, that may not be instantaneous, but over time, if you have two quite distinct tax systems sitting close by each other, you do create incentives.
Mr. Souza, do you have any particular views about how we have a strategic objective that will allow us to create more economic growth? Not necessarily related to tax, actually, but what do we have to do to get more economic growth?
So I think what both Davids have talked about in terms of infrastructure is really important. And so I think I'm talking in my response about the cumulative effect of infrastructure spending and investment in the capital stock. And that's really important. Like every year that there is less investment, there's less capital stock built, that compounds over time. And so Scotland's got lower overall investment than the UK and significantly lower than the OECD. So it's lower by about a quarter, which means that productivity, which is very heavily linked to the level of capital per worker, is going to grow more slowly. So that's really important. And that's where one of the places where the public sector can make a difference in terms of inducing growth. The other thing, I think I would echo the point about tax. I think it's important to think about how the tax system in Scotland compares with the UK system, both in terms of the tax rates on non-saving, non-dividend income, but also savings and dividend income, and trying to avoid kind of kinks in the schedule is really important, and that's something that has to be considered when deciding things like thresholds as well as rates. And obviously, like small divergences probably won't make a huge amount of difference, but the effects can really be non-linear as well. So if you increase income tax on a particular band by 1p, fine. Increase it by 2p, you're changing incentives a bit. Increase it by 5p, that's a big difference. So that's something that needs to be considered as well.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ross. We're followed by Michael.
Thanks. Come here. I'd like to just pick up a little bit on what Mr. Souza said around public opinion and challenge that idea a little bit that there's kind of wide-scale public opposition to increasing tax. Because I'm looking at two polls from roughly this time last year. One, the Scottish poll was actually from last December. That showed a majority of people, and a margin of more than 2-1, supportive rather than opposed to the Scottish Government's increase in the high rate of income tax. There was a UK-wide poll just before the Liz Truss mini-budget showing a majority of people in favour of increasing taxes to increase spending on, amongst other things, social security, which is interesting given the attempts at demonising that. And even if you look at the last British election study, the vast majority of the UK electorate have left-of-centre economic values, even if they wouldn't use a label like that, including a majority of Conservative voters. So I recognise there's a difference between public opinion and the actual effect of public policy changes. So if every GP in the country was in the minority of people opposed to tax rises and half them moved to Australia as a result of tax rises, that would have an impact, clearly. But is there an issue here when we're talking about particularly what John touched on there and public discussion of taxation, that public discourse as defined by politicians and by experts is in a space really quite far removed from where the majority of public opinion actually is in terms of core economic values?
I think that there's two things. Obviously, you were talking about that specific policy, and I'm perfectly happy to concede that I wasn't aware of those particular numbers. But I think, as with all kind of policies and kind of intentions of policies, support tends to be higher when they're less specific and to fall when specifics are introduced. So that's something that to take into account, especially if, going forward and looking at future tax policies. I think I won't necessarily comment on whether I think the public are in a particular part of the political spectrum, but I think it is important to try and gauge those views more systematically and try and have that conversation about tax. It's also important, and I'll come back to what I was talking about, of having like a long-term view of where we want to end up, because we've had multiple groups about tax, and in the medium-term financial strategy there was a mention of a national conversation about tax, which is, you know, one of a number of conversations that have been put forward on this over time. And actually, it's important to think about the levers. It's important to think about also like the just having a plan that gets discussed rather than just saying generally, you know, want to do more or less, like actually having a plan and how that plan fits in with the overall aims of what it gets spent on. Because especially in a system like the one that the Scottish Government operates under, which requires a roughly balanced budget, there is a direct link between tax and expenditure that is less true at a UK level, where there's an overall change in fiscal stance that you could take, which is not available to the Scottish Government.
Professor Bell, do you have any thoughts on this? Because if I'm remembering correctly, the Citizens' Assembly that you mentioned came up with a pretty long list of potential new tax and revenue-raising powers. So that there was, certainly within that Assembly, which is supposed to be broadly representative, there was a pretty broad consensus around not just the need to raise additional revenue, but to broaden the sources of revenue. I'd be interested in your thoughts on where public opinion actually sits on these kind of questions.
I suspect public opinion is probably broadly in favour of increasing taxation. As we've heard, you know, in general terms, that's not a difficult proposition to agree with. What is more difficult is when you're actually confronted by the effect on you of the changes that might occur. And I'm not an expert on public opinion at all, but we do know that economic realities sometimes bite, and nothing more so than with Brexit. Public opinion was obviously in favour of Brexit, and I'm afraid the chickens are coming home to roost now.
I mean, I think the numbers that Ross referred to tend to have changed through time. I mean, if you go back to 1979, there's been shifts between when people wanted less tax and less spend, or more tax and more spend. The old point I would make, though, is that people tend to have a view that the best taxes are taxes that other people are thought to pay. So that's the problem. That's the problem. And I've already made the point that 5% of Scottish taxpayers pay roughly 40% of total revenues in Scotland from income tax. So it's actually the behavioural response of a relatively small group of high earning taxpayers that is actually relevant to the Scottish Fiscal Commission's numbers. And I mean, whether the Scottish Fiscal Commission is right to be so pessimistic about the effects of, for example, the dropping the top rate threshold and the higher rate, and putting up the top rate, I don't know, and we'll find out in due course. But it only requires the movement of a relatively small number of taxpayers to have a significant effect on Scottish tax revenues, because at the top end, people might be paying very large amounts of tax, and if they relocate themselves to England or Switzerland or wherever you like, that could have a significant effect. So I think that one should be cautious about assuming. And also, there's also the question of you've got to think about the kind of tax package that people face. I mean, Paul Johnson, the Institute for Fiscal Studies, is regularly denounces stamp duty land tax in England and land and building transaction tax in Scotland by implication, because it actually impedes mobility. It impedes labour market mobility. It impedes people downsizing. So I think one has also got to think about, when one's trying to get more money out of high income groups, you've got to think about the various ways in which they're taxed. And as David Bell has already said, one's got to be very careful about the overall picture where people make migration decisions and labour supply decisions.
Just sticking with you in the first instance for this, David, though interested in others' views. I think it's quite easy for us to get stuck in a bit of a chorus of despair about this, because we all acknowledge we're facing the greatest financial challenge in devolution's short history so far. But at the same time, as you've all mentioned, particularly Professor Bell, you're mentioning, we've got really ambitious targets in terms of hitting net zero, lifting children out of poverty, etc. Inevitably, whether it's the net zero targets or child poverty targets, substantial increases in spending are going to be required if we're to stand any chance of hitting those targets, even if you were very committed to a laissez-faire, free market economic model. On net zero in particular, that we don't have enough time left to find out whether that would work or not. We have such a limited period of time. You've all identified some serious challenges in us raising additional revenue through taxation. The opportunities for us to cut spending elsewhere are extremely limited within the context of the Scottish budget. So it's hard not to feel as if you're trying to edge us towards acknowledging that realistically these targets that the government has set, the objectives, are not realistic with the financial resources available to us. Is that fair?
Well, I mean, we're obviously depends on what the UK government does, because the Scottish system functions relative to the UK government. But I go back to the point that it's the marginal rate of tax that matters for incentives and the average rate that matters for progressivity. So I would actually be in favour of a more progressive tax system if you get the tax system right. Now, 1991 values for council tax, just bring it into total disrepute. The peaks we were talking about in the marginal rate of threshold are ridiculous, but they potentially, in the longer term, have serious consequences. So I think that we need a debate. And as the chair has implied, nothing will ever happen without a degree of cross-party consensus on what to do. No government, given the proportional representation, this parliament's always going to be very tight in terms of parliamentary majorities. Nobody's going to have a massive Blair-type majority here. So the consequence is you need a consensus of the parties to actually try and settle the problem. Now, we've had 25 years and that's not happened.
Can I just jump in? So, do you think that's possible, the aligned and progressive tax model that you're talking about, is that possible purely with currently devolved levers if the UK government was not to work in lockstep, for example, on the child benefit policy that you've identified? Is it actually possible for us to do that just with what's currently available under the devolution settlement?
Well, I mean, I think that if we managed our own local government taxation properly, if we managed our income tax properly, I think we'd have more standing in conjunction with the Welsh Government and the Northern Ireland Executive when it exists. I mean, the devolved administration, the UK is essentially paralysed. I mean, we've had five chancellors in about as many years. So, I mean, the UK has got its own problems. What the devolved administrations can do is give some leadership in some leadership. The UK is just a very strange animal, because most federations have at least a reasonable distribution, a reasonable number of jurisdictions within that federation, and one jurisdiction dominates. I think Ontario is the biggest, at about 35% of Canada. The UK, England is 84-85% of the UK. That totally imbalances the system. But I do think the devolved administrations, and I would commend the work that the Northern Ireland Fiscal Council has done, it's produced a very good guide to Northern Ireland public finances. And to some extent it did that because Northern Ireland, the Northern Ireland Stormont, the collapse of Stormont meant that there wasn't an executive in place to do it. But I think one of the things the committee could press for is for the Scottish Government or somebody to produce an authoritative guide to the way that this very complex system works.
Thank you. Anybody else want to come in on that?
If I could go back to the net zero strategic objective, as I've said, the most obvious way to... Well, you can do that in two ways. One is to tax carbon and the other is to provide incentives for reducing carbon usage. And essentially, that won't happen without a huge amount of investment. And that requires government spending to de-risk investment by the private sector in areas which will reduce our carbon usage. And that in itself, firstly, taxing carbon is distributionally problematic, as I've already said. And secondly, providing incentives for the private sector, which is the only sector with a significant amount of money to invest at the moment, is problematic because the public sector needs to put in some money so that to take a bit of the risk out of investment in that area. So I guess what I would say is that you've got to be upfront about the challenges that are you know, being faced. I'm not saying it's impossible, but there are, it seems to me all of the discussion has suggested that there are too many demands on the public purse at the moment for them all to be simultaneously satisfied, and in a sense there's got to be a prioritisation.
Could I just pick up on something that David said? That some carbon taxation is going to be regressive. Alcohol taxation is regressive. Tobacco taxation is regressive. But I support those taxation, but it matters what the system as a whole is like. One's got to look at the whole system. There may be very good public policy reasons for tobacco taxation and alcohol taxation. But we know that they are distributionally regressive, but you've got to think about how the system as a whole works. And it's obviously partly a problem of having the UK government taxing, the Scottish government taxing, and local authorities taxing. So it makes a degree of fiscal coordination much more important. I mean, we haven't had fiscal coordination even within Scotland. I mean, one of the reasons why local authorities are short of money is we had a 9-year council tax freeze.
Thank you.
Okay, Michael, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Camilla. The tax working group that the government put in place is looking at this increase to the higher rate, and it's been discussed already. I think that the SFC are modelling that at £128 million on the static costings, and then with behaviour effects down at £92 million. You mentioned, Professor Heald, that around the change from 46 to 47 pence rate, that the static costing was £32 million and post-behavioural was £3 million. Could you say a little bit about what you think the reason for, so one of those loses 90% of its value and the other one a smaller percentage? Maybe explain a little bit of that.
I'm not a fiscal modeller. That's a question you'll have to put to the Scottish Fiscal Commission.
Anybody else?
I'm happy to talk about that. So the way the Scottish Fiscal Commission models this is that there's different what's called taxable income elasticity. So the level of response by reducing either work hours or changing patterns of payments that people use to get income changes much more the higher your income is. So I think the Scottish Fiscal Commission assumes that is quite low up until I think £150,000, and then higher from there to £300,000, and then above £500,000 is much higher, and that's why you get such a loss. in the standard costing from that.
Okay. And do you have confidence in those numbers?
So all these costings are very uncertain just by the nature of it, because they usually apply to relatively low numbers of taxpayers. It's very hard to do good studies on it. There's HMRC and is currently doing an assessment of what the effect of changing rates in Scotland has been in terms of movement within the UK, but as also in terms of changes in taxable income. So we will get some more evidence in due course. I mean, it's very hard to be extremely precise. If say the OBR, when they do this kind of assessment, they would probably rank this as a very high uncertainty costing. But I think it's pretty well established that the higher your income is, the more likely you are to respond to tax changes.
So as a panel, you've given us illustrated some risks you think are coming. So Professor Hield, you mentioned about, you know, if we teach higher earning public sector workers to avoid tax, in essence, the more people that are going to be involved in where our income might come from, that there's real risks in terms of the longer term. I mean, I suppose overall, that 92 million is into a kind of a black hole of nearly £2 billion that we're looking at by 2027-28. Given the risks that you've illustrated, do you think it's worth it?
I mean, if I'd been advising the finance minister, I would not have regarded putting up the high rate and the additional rate as something to do. I would have tried to get rid of the. I would have tried to redo the rate structure to try and get rid of these sudden peaks. The real problem, of course, is the question of the alignment of the national insurance threshold with the rest of the UK tax system. But I think that teaching people who would not normally go in for tax avoidance how to do tax avoidance is not a very sensible policy. So I would try and clean up the schedule. And very clearly, and it goes back to what Grass Greer was saying, if there is a change of public mood, one's got to make an argument for people that the system should become more progressive, and it may have to become more progressive if things like carbon taxes are regressive to actually offset that effect.
David Bell.
I'd agree that measuring elasticities. Income tax elasticities the different bodies are doing it to the best of their ability, but there is still quite a large margin for error. I agree with David Heald that the rather strange structure illustrated in the diagram for our marginal rates makes no sense at all. I'm not convinced that even getting all of that right will change the revenues in such a way that you're making a very significant impact on what the forthcoming deficit looks like. And really, economic growth, however you want to define it, sustainable, associated with well-being or whatever, nevertheless, is something that that will drive revenue, the income side of Scotland's balance sheet, more positively.
I mean, we're still suffering from the global financial crisis.
Yeah.
I mean, it goes back until 2008, the economy was doing reasonably well. Since then, the UK economy and the Scottish economy as well have performed badly. So it's a question of getting over that shock. And of course, we then got the COVID shock and the cost of living crisis.
And none of this accounts for behavioural effects that are external. So if I'm looking for a breast cancer oncologist in NHS Tayside, a very competitive international situation where that person could have multiple job offers. That's the kind of messaging that you're concerned about.
Yes.
Absolutely.
I mean, if you get stuff in the sports pages about footballers and managers who come to the UK from abroad wanting to bargain for their net pay, not for their gross pay. And I can imagine if you're trying to hire consultants or top scientists, that's going to be the kind of argument that public sector bodies in Scotland are going to have.
David Bell.
No, I was just, I guess I was agreeing with David on that front. But, I mean, it is also important, I think, to ensure that in the tax system, everyone feels that they are making a contribution. The fact that we've only got, you know, that 40% of the income tax revenue is being generated by a relatively small number of people is in itself a big risk. And therefore, you know, there's a case, if we can, to increase the number of people with jobs that are paying less well than that. You know, that may be how you define sustainable growth is to try and switch that balance by giving it would have to be quite a large number of people jobs that are below top rates, and we need as David says we've struggled to do that since the financial crisis.
Can I ask about the gearing then and the relationship between the UK and Scotland? I mean, you said that obviously the Scottish system performs relative to the UK, always will, whatever the constitutional settlement in some regards. How exposed are we? We've talked about there are, in the SFC projections, there are different measures of what our demographic trends are, and that's a key factor within that. Within those assumptions, are we more exposed, do you believe, than other parts of the UK?
So I wouldn't say we're necessarily more exposed than all other parts of the UK. We're probably more exposed than the South East is. The demographics are quite difficult to interpret. Firstly, we've just had a census, so we will get in due course another set of population projections, which will replace the ones that SFC have been using. And as I show, population projections do tend to vary themselves quite a bit. That will have an influence. And then there's the effect of changing demographic structure and how that affects spending. That in itself is also a contested area, as I kind of allude to in my paper, the assumption that necessarily spending, and particularly health spending, increases with age is a theory that is not fully accepted across the board. So how spending on health is growing is something that seems to me that the Health and Sport Committee, obviously, and the Finance Committee have to keep a very close watch on.
You said, sorry, in your submission that if one assumes the UK government will take action to avoid the public finances continuing on an unsustainable path, the Scottish government's funding gap looks very different. I mean, there is a gearing issue here, isn't there?
Well, there is a real issue that the projections that the SFC have made are on the basis as I mentioned in my response, of a what is essentially an unsustainable path for the UK government. And that's why the gap looks like it's under 2%, because the block grant just grows a lot because UK spending grows by a lot. The relationship between the two is intrinsically... So if the UK government, under the current constitutional and fiscal framework, if the UK government cuts back on that spending or doesn't increase it quite as fast, then all else equal, the funding position for the Scottish government looks worse. So that is something that has to be managed in that context.
Okay. And my last question, I suppose, maybe it's more of an observation, but on the multi-year budgets, I mean, you mentioned about political instability, David Hill, in terms of 2016. I mean, I recall calls for multi-year budgets going back as early as 2010. When we suppose, looking back now, think we had political stability because the Scottish Government wasn't delivering it at that point. Is there something that's a bit more intrinsic in the political performance of this place and our institutions, the relationship with local government, that means it's not... I recognise that instability is now the key driving factor within that, but it's a longer-term problem.
Yes, I mean, I think that there were reasonable length spending reviews until 2015. And then since that period, since 2015, has had a whole series of very short-term reviews, whatever they were called, So I think that, we need more stability at the UK level so that that stability gets transferred back down to the Scottish Government, which it can now transfer down to the local authorities. I mean, there's pressure from other people who have given evidence to the committee for multi-year budgeting, I totally understand that. But, of course, if the Scottish Government hasn't got a degree of stability itself, it's very difficult to give genuine stability promises down the system.
But even under those relatively stable longer-term budgets, the Scottish Government still didn't deliver multi-year funding settlements to Scottish public services prior to 2015. They didn't do it. I mean, I've here people calling for it in 2013. I suppose I'm challenging this because I worry that, you know, yes, the instability and political instability in the UK to me is the key issue right now. And if we can't deliver against that, that's a big problem, and let's hope we can. But is there something about the way this place is performing that means actually people are more reactive in setting one-year budgets? I just wonder if we won't find that as the solution.
I think so. My view and the view of the Fraser of Allen Institute would be that there is a possibility to do, even under the current arrangement and the instability that there has been in the last few years, there is a possibility to take a multi-year approach, this more kind of risk management. So you look at things like what is the baseline level that we can expect if nothing changes, and then as you get more defined funding, like you get closer to that time, then you revise that. And I think that would be informative for the public debate because people can see where things are going over time. I also think that it is natural that as Parliament kind of build in their processes, everything starts with kind of like the immediate pressures. And then I think it is within the Scottish Parliament's gift to try and impose that structure, and that's something that could be looked at by MSPs as a whole.
Could I come back to your earlier point about demography? I think it's important not just to look at demography at the Scottish level. A smaller population makes you think that you'll be able to save money because of less people to provide services for. But what you might find is you've got redundant facilities in the parts of Scotland where people are moving from, and you need new facilities in the parts of Scotland that they're going to. So I think there's a spatial dimension to the demographic problem. It's not just the total Scottish population, it's where the people live and work. And I've made the point earlier about the fact that there's been this long-term decline in the prosperity of the west of Scotland and increasing prosperity in the east of Scotland, so that, you know, Aberdeenshire, for example, has required a lot more schools, whereas you might have spare capacity in places in the west.
And a more dispersed population is one of the founding principles of the Barnett formula, which we benefit from as well, of course. But okay, thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Bill 204 by Jamie.
Good morning. I'd love to be able to lead us on to a topic that cheers us all up a bit, but I'm not convinced I'm going to be able to manage that. I mean, I suppose my first question is, you've given such, all of you, such a kind of compelling sense of the kind of macro environment of the UK. Chronic underinvestment, CapEx, high debt relative to GDP, demographic challenges, Brexit, short-termism, you know, the list goes on. Oh, and of course, the slowest recovery of all large advanced economies after the crash of 2008. You've also given us a very compelling insight into the limitations of Scotland being part of that wider economy. My first question, I've got two, is do you think that the challenges are really understood. I think they're understood by economists. I think they're understood mostly by government. But I'm quite aware that following this session, we've got another session coming up, which invariably we hear a number of bodies looking for more money, and with very, very good reason, because people are really struggling. But to what extent is that realistic, and to what extent is actually the real nub of the issue short-term political expediency against long-term structural and strategic planning, and that being an issue in the UK over a long period of time and in Scotland? David Bell, do you want to go first?
Thank you. So, certainly, we're coming up to a period where the challenges are such that starting new initiatives will have to be examined with a much finer lens than has been the case in the past. With some, you know, possibly you should be thinking about, well, one out, one in. What policy are you going to cut in order for this new policy to come in? We're, as you alluded to, we're in a period of huge political instability, and that has not helped. Looking at the through the longer term, of course, the one little bit of stability that we had were the structural funds, which were running over a seven-year period and have now pretty much disappeared to be replaced by basically annual budgets on everything. We can certainly improve the way that the tax system works, but I think that productivity is a greater problem, is a more important problem. And trying to increase the productivity of workers in Scotland, and that interacts with all of the other things that we've been talking about, demography, and so on. It's very difficult to say no, but there are very serious trade-offs that are going to come about unless the revenues improve, and the tax system generates at least as much as we're currently getting. So I think the key issue that maybe the Parliament can help with is making sure there's transparency around this and not letting things kind of drift into a very difficult situation, which, if I was to pick out two examples, it would be capital spend and local government.
And just before I bring in Professor Heald, your comment about productivity, surely there's a link with the limitations in capital borrowing powers as a critical way for the Scottish Government to improve productivity. Is there not a direct link because of that still pretty significant limitation if you're going to improve
productivity? It seems to me that public sector capital spend can improve infrastructure, which in itself can have a beneficial effect on productivity. It can also, if used wisely, sort of de-risk private sector investments. It can be a catalyst for the private sector to invest. But, you know, that we have to be able to do that in a way which actually does generate the productivity enhancements that we're talking about. We want to avoid at all costs the infrastructure investment that is not leading to improved economic performance in one way or another.
Yeah. Professor Heald?
I concur with most of that. Very clearly, given the fact we've not recovered from the 2008 hit, we are dependent on the economy doing better. So whether we talk in terms of improved productivity, whether you talk in terms of just of economic growth, that is what actually happens on that front is crucial to the fiscal prospects of the Scottish government. Some of the issues you referred to stem from the present constitutional arrangement, but an independent Scotland would be very, very much affected by what was actually happening in its much bigger neighbour. And the tax-type questions we've been talking about would actually very much apply. So if Scotland was an independent country, it would still have the question of the relationship of its tax system relative to the tax system in the UK.
That's very true of Ireland at the moment. Ireland managed to get in very low corporation tax rates, but its income tax structure is not that much different.
Mm-hmm. And so, Professor Hugh, you used the term coherent strategy. Now, I'm long enough in the tooth in this committee not to say what would you do if you were the Scottish Government, but perhaps we could phrase it as what would you do if you were in charge of an economy of people size roughly 5.4 million located to a large neighbour. What would be the key elements of that coherent strategy that you outline?
Well, in the present constitutional context, I've already answered it. In the independence context, to which you were leading me, one of the temptations would be for a small country to have lower taxes than its big neighbour. And kind of when some people on the political left think that independence is going to be a socialist paradise, one of the points that I would always make to them is that the actual temptations will be for Scotland to try to have lower taxes than England. Whereas what we're in a position now is that Scotland has marginally higher taxes than the rest of the UK. But I think that in an independent situation, one would probably find a small country next to a very big neighbour tempted to have lower taxes. Canada is obviously an exception to that because in relative terms, Canada's very small relative to the US and actually has higher taxes. But you can only do that if you have a political consensus for higher taxes. People keep talking about Scandinavia, but the point is a political consensus has built up in most of the Scandinavian countries that is actually different to either when the UK did have a political consensus and to the present moment when it doesn't have one.
Yeah. And Mr. Souza, final comment to you about my original question about basically the issue around short-term political expediency versus long-term strategy.
So I think what I would say is thinking about the limitations in terms of the budget that the Scottish Government faces. Again, it kind of comes back to the point about not thinking that resource is the main... And I know that there's different management systems for resource and capital spending, but there is always a temptation to try and, you know, exchange some capital to pay for reserve pressures today. But as I outlined before, Scotland already has a relatively low capital spending and that kind of accumulates over time. So it's really important to keep in mind that cuts to capital today can have a significant impact on growth and productivity in the long term.
Okay, thank you
very much. That's concluded questions from the committee. I'm going to just ask one further question myself. Given all the talk about increasing taxes, I think the government's probably going to play it safe and just impose fiscal drag on us all, as both the Scottish and UK governments did last year. And I would say, of course, just to echo what Professor Heald has said, that income tax rises are always popular among those who are not going to have to pay them. And when the SNP brought in the Penny for Scotland campaign, which would be 1% on the basic rate, I believe our opinion poll rating went down from 48% to an eventual 27%. I was standing in the constituency of the highest unemployment in Scotland, and people who hadn't had a job were denouncing us on that, believe it or not, even though one would have thought they'd have benefited. But just the question I was going to ask was one I've not really touched on, which is yesterday it was announced that the pension funds, some of the pension funds such as Scarclyde, are so awash with money now that they're going to reduce the local government contributions by about two-thirds over the next couple of years, which will be a wee boon to local authorities. But is there a possibility for the Scottish Government to tap in perhaps to pension funds in terms of being able to fund some of its capital projects? Joe, do you want to have a go at that one?
I mean, I think it bringing in that kind of thing through direct action can have some risks, and the main duty of the people looking after those funds is to ensure their solvency, and it's important not to interfere too directly in that in a way that makes that viability problematic. So I would caution against this looking at something immediately as a pot of money and just going after it directly. I remember in my experience in Portugal, pension funds being directed to buy government bonds when rates were high, because it would help bring them down, and that turned out to be a disaster. And I think in general, those are quite separate things, and one shouldn't necessarily just go after it immediately.
Thinking more about things like housing, for example, where there would be a return to the pension fund long term, and I appreciate that funds are there specifically to try and maximise income for their members, although some pension funds are looking at, have looked over the last years about ethical investments, tobacco or carbon intensive industries. So
I think the way that could be done is to make that investment more attractive per se, rather than necessarily directing them to do that. That would be my view.
Okay. I don't know if anyone else has got...
I'm instinctively nervous about directed pension fund investment. What I would say is I think the Scottish Government and the devolved administrations generally ought to be arguing with the UK Government about not cutting capital del. I mean, if I was running the system, the UK would actually not cut back capital in response to the present fiscal problem. Yeah. It would probably expand capital for the growth reasons we've actually been talked to. In terms of the mechanics for the Scottish Parliament, that could either be enhanced capital borrowing powers, which is possibly unlikely given the fact it's not significantly in the new fiscal framework, or just capital delts. You could either have more capital borrowing, capital borrowing oneself, or higher capital del coming through Barnett.
Yeah, I mean, it's a cut about 10% the current financial year. Professor Bell, just...
Hey, so I find this an interesting idea. I would be wary of taking it too far, because I think pension funds' responsibilities have to be seen to be the contributors to their pensions. But we do know that there are quite a few overseas pension funds that invest in aspects of the Scottish economy and the UK economy more generally. It'd be good to understand what motivated their investment in bits of infrastructure in the UK, and try to understand what kind of incentive could be put in place, maybe to leverage out some of that money to effectively to replace at least some of the capital del that's being lost.
Okay. I don't know the mechanics, but as part of the Private Finance 2, which the Treasury announced in 1998, there was going to be more pension fund investment in public sector capital projects, but that quietly died.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm going to conclude by allowing our witnesses to make one final comment on any issue that they feel we haven't touched on, that they think we should have done, or there's something else they want to reinforce with regard to what they've said. earlier. Who would like to go first? David Bell.
One point that I made, I've sort of alluded to, is understanding the causes of why health spending increases. I think it's important to get a handle of that on that, given that the projections suggest over 50% of the budget's going that way in about 5 years' time. This is a very contested area, and it's about the question of whether health spending increases as you get older, or whether health spending increases with proximity to death.
Right, a nice cheery comment there. Professor Heald?
I think it's very important. I mean, if you get something like 50% of the Scottish budget going on health, there's going to be devastating consequences for the rest of the budget, given the likely total spend. I think it's also very important that we recognise that health is not just affected by health spending. The quality of the environment that people live in, the quality of the housing they live in, the fact that they've got rewarding jobs, both financially and in terms of satisfaction, are actually really very important. And I think one of the worries about the decline of local government spend, problems on the local government side, is that I'm sure that some of the backlash from the cuts in local government spend are actually reverberating on the health service. So I think it's very important to see the connections between the different kinds of spend.
I think some of our witnesses in the next panel will be touching on that. And Joe, we started and we'll finish with you.
I'm going to bring it to something a little different that we haven't talked about, but that I put in my submission, which is I think it would be important in as part of the process of multi-year budgeting, also looking at what the government compares its spending plans with. And I think we have reinforced a bit the fact that we think that it would be important to have more information about in-year execution and about comparing plans with actual outturns of what's happened, because we may be missing some important information about how much of the allocation, say, of capital is actually being spent in year. The 10% cut in the allocation may be a different percentage than on the actual execution. And it also might mean that the Scottish Government could prioritise different capital projects to ensure maximum utilisation of allocations rather than just focusing on the overall plans.
Yeah, I think it's important we don't compare apples with oranges, basically. I think that was an important point. OK, well, thank you very much to our witnesses. You've given us lots of food for thought for the second panel and indeed beyond. So we'll now call a break until 11:23. Folks, we continue our evidence taking on the sustainability of Scotland's finances with a roundtable discussion. I'd therefore like to welcome to the meeting Adam Sakura, Head of Policy and Communications at Age Scotland, Dr. Judith Turbine, Chief Executive, Children in Scotland, Philip White, Director, Institute of Public Policy Research Scotland, Stuart Hay, Director, Living Streets Scotland, Ruth Boyle, Policy and Campaigns Manager, The Poverty Alliance, Michael Kellett, Director of Strategy, Governance and Performance, Public Health Scotland, and Alistair Sim, Director of University Scotland. So I want to thank everyone for their written submissions. And the way we're going to do this is, rather than me ask a whole load of different questions, I'm only going to ask one question, which will be to you, Ruth, to kick us off. And then anyone who wants to comment on what Ruth has said, if they just let me know, and we'll just buzz around the table so that everyone gets the maximum opportunity to speak, and I will only come in as and when, i.e. not very often, which will satisfy John, because he's always moaning about how much I speak at these events. Okay. So, Ruth, your submission, which is very detailed and excellent submission, is called The Case for Fair Tax Reform in Scotland. And you will have heard some of what the economists before you've said, and what they basically talked about is, well, let's see what you've said, first of all. You've talked about it's important that critical national priorities cannot be sacrificed due to a lack of funds. You've talked about new and improved forms of local taxation that target undertaxed wealth as well as business and polluters. You've called for a fundamental rethink from scratch of how income tax can best be designed. You've called for a cross-party process to replace the council tax. And you called for a local inheritance and local payroll tax. Now, one of the things that the economists said, basically, was that we have a small, finite group of people who pay a very high proportion of tax in Scotland. And they have real concerns about behavioural impact. For example, if we do decide to go down the road of increasing taxes significantly. So I'm wondering how you feel we can deliver what the Poverty Alliance wants to deliver in terms of its social policy, and how we can actually fund these, given the constraints that the economists presented to us in terms of not only the fiscal gap that the Scottish Government has just now, but the impact on higher taxpayers should some of these policies be implemented, i.e. they might leave Scotland, or they might decide to work less, basically, or they might have more avoidance. So, Ruth, the floor is yours.
Thank you, and thank you very much for inviting the Poverty Alliance to give evidence today. I'm really pleased to be here. The reason that we are here is because we think that it's totally unjust that people would be experiencing poverty in a wealthy country like Scotland, yet right now we see that a quarter of a million of our children are currently living and having their life chances restricted by the injustice of preventable poverty. You're right that we think that key national priorities can't be sacrificed due to a lack of resources. We see in the latest scrutiny report from the Poverty and Inequality Commission that the investment in the actions in Best Start Bright Future haven't matched the ambition of those policies. Now, Philip and I are here today to represent more than 50 organisations who endorsed a briefing on using our tax powers progressively. And those 50 organisations have come together with a very simple message. And it's that to see the transformational change that we know is needed to meet our national priorities on poverty and the climate, we need to see transformational investment. And in the current economic and fiscal environment, we think that that necessitates a progressive use of Scotland's taxation powers. We know that Scotland has taken a more progressive approach to tax than the rest of the UK so far, but what we're calling for in our briefing is for the Scottish Government to go further and faster. We heard very stark modelling earlier today in terms of that £1.9 billion shortfall by 2027-28. And that's going to put pressure on existing spending, never mind the additional resource that we know is necessary to meet those national priorities. Now, what that would mean if we don't take progressive action on tax will be further cuts. In the papers for the committee today, we see that local authorities are saying that all of the easy cuts have been made. And we see from the people and the community organisations that we work with day to day that that's absolutely the case. People are still dealing with the impact of over a decade of austerity, and we know that any further cuts are going to have a really tangible impact on their lives, particularly because in some cases that will mean cuts to statutory services. We've outlined a range of options in the paper today, which I'm sure Philip and I will be able to talk through over the course of the session. In the short term, we are outlining options to use our income tax powers more progressively. We
pointed that out. That what the economists have said, though, is that if you implement some of these policies, you will not actually get any more money because the people will simply A, avoid it, B, work less hard, or C, will leave Scotland. So, for example, what they said was that when the top rate went up by one penny in the pound last year, 90% of that revenue was actually lost to behavioural change. So someone who might work 5 days a week will just say, do you know what, I'm just going to work 4 days a week because I'm not going to lose all this money to tax. Why should I work for that? So it's one thing to say, oh, if we do X, we'll raise 500 million extra in tax or whatever the figure would be. But if you're going to lose 90% of that, or possibly the opposite, actually end up losing, you know, you implement 500 million of tax, but because of those changes, you lose 600 million tax. It doesn't deliver the changes that you and I'm sure, well, everybody really wants to deliver. I think everybody wants to tackle poverty, and we want to have better paid jobs, etc., etc., and more money for the health service. But how do we realistically fund that when the impact of behavioural change is so fundamental to doing that? How do we? It's one, you can raise tax as much as you like, but if the money goes elsewhere, how do you do that?
I think we see in the papers for today's committee, the Scottish Fiscal Commission have said that behavioural change is challenging to quantify. When we're putting forward progressive policy change, we do often see a slight backlash in terms of what might be the unintended consequences of it. We've seen that from policy changes from the national minimum wage, for example. I think when there were changes to non-DOM status in 2017, there was a lot of concern that would lead to a sort of mass exodus. When you look at analysis from the University of Warwick, that doesn't actually play out in terms of what happened. I think we need to be clear that there is a range of reasons why people choose to build their lives in Scotland, and I think that would move beyond simple tax powers. But also, we need to make sure that if we are going to increase tax, that people feel the benefit of that taxation in terms of the local public services that they have and the opportunities that they have. When you look at polling, we would absolutely disagree that tax isn't popular. So we see polling from IPPR Scotland that shows that 60% of people support tax increases, even if it means their tax would go up if that was invested in our social safety net. Similarly, in the Scottish Social Attitude Survey, we see an increasing majority supporting this redistribution of wealth from those who are better off to least well off. And also, I think when we're talking about this people working less, this is one of the fundamental issues with our tax system, is that it's overly reliant on income tax. So we rely on income tax to do much of the heavy lifting. And actually, one of the key points put forward in our briefing is that we need to shift the dial towards taxing wealth. That's a really untapped potential in terms of how we could raise the revenue, and that's why we've put forward other proposals around replacing the council tax with the property value tax or that local inheritance tax as well. So we shouldn't get solely focused on income tax, but instead be looking at this package of reform.
Okay, Philip, you're the only other person who's indicated you want to come in, so if anyone else wants to come in, don't be shy, put your hands up. Philip, you've actually, you were obviously nodding a lot to what Ruth was actually saying, but one of the things the economists actually said was that wealth tax are complex to implement and can take several years. So we're obviously looking at the budget for 24-25. So even assuming that we thought that the wealth taxes were appropriate and could be implemented, what kind of time period are we talking about, and what can be done for this forthcoming tax year, which is the one that obviously is staring us in the face now?
Yep. A couple of things. So I think we acknowledge, obviously, the pressures on income tax. The figures are in there. You've got 1% of taxpayers in the top rate and only 5% in the higher rate. So we know that it's quite a small group, and that's been well recognised. So there's an argument here about we need to grow the economy as much as we need to grow the tax base as much as anything. I think that is well recognised. I think on behavioural effects, I think I wasn't here. The joys of being in Health Committee, which I'm sure lots of can repeat lots of what I said there this morning, and there are people's scrutiny here. But I think, as Riz has alluded to, the evidence around behavioural impact right now with the devolution of SRIT is incredibly limited, so we still don't quite know what's going on. I think there's two factors that are particularly pertinent. One is there's a very high proportion of public sector workers sitting in the higher and top rates because of the high proportion of public sector workforce in general in Scotland. The other is, right since the devolution of income tax to Scotland, the simplest way to avoid it would be to shift your income into dividends, given the fact it was simply non-saving, non-dividends income that was devolved. So I think it's also a question of devolution settlement and how it can be addressed through that. But I think overall, the questions around behaviour changes still aren't quite known yet. But I think to go on to your more substantive point, so you look just at this year, there's obviously a question about sustainability of public finances, so we absolutely have to look long-term. In terms of the short term, obviously, this First Minister has spoken previously about their attraction to introducing a new rate and band between the current higher and top rate. We've set out some options for what you could do there. But I think the other thing is, and Rhys alluded to it, and again, timescales probably do not allow you potentially to do it for April, but I think you need to go as far as you possibly can. We recognise that income is potentially limited given the size of the taxpayer base in Scotland. We also know that wealth is a hugely untapped resource in Scotland. So right now, the richest households have 217 times the wealth of the least wealthy households. So there's a huge, huge, huge disparity. And then you start to look at where that wealth is held. It's held in property. It's, again, the single largest asset that people have wealth in. So that is why we have kicked it into the long grass for years. I've lost count of the number of commissions and manifesto commitments and reviews and everything else that we've undertaken into council tax. We know it's outdated. We know it's regressive. We know it's not playing its full role in kind of revenue raising in Scotland. We absolutely need to replace council tax. So again, there's a question why revaluation will take a long time. Could you do that by April? Potentially not. But at the very least, starting to go further, it's obviously the Scottish Government set out its options for starting to play around with the multipliers and increase them for the higher bands. I think we've basically approached that as a necessary evil and cautiously welcome in that we know that it still has some regressive elements, albeit council tax reduction smooths that out to quite a significant chunk. And again, it's in the paper in more detail in there. But I think that's your most immediate option. We can go further in income tax right now. We can do more with council tax. But to just keep tinkering around the edges of both of those things is going to leave a lot of revenue untapped and ensure that kind of we continue to have that relatively small base of taxpayers.
Tempted to come back in, but joined before by Michael.
Yeah, OK, thanks very much. I mean, we have concentrated so far on how can we raise more tax for the existing expenditure, but to be, and I'm sympathetic to that, but to be a little bit devil's advocate, are there areas of expenditure that we could cut back on? For example, is the Scottish social security system too generous compared to the UK? Because the previous panel told us that making up that difference is having an effect on other services. Linked to that, is the Scottish Government trying, has it got too many priorities? Should we be trying to simplify things, just a few of them? And what about the idea of, are we being too generous with giving say the bus pass to everybody? Should we be more means testing, targeting some of that expenditure?
Okay, so John isn't asking a specific question, is that right? You're just looking for people to respond?
Yes.
Okay, so does anyone want to respond to that? I'll let yourself in and then Ruth before I let Michael in. Okay.
Okay, I'll start off with sort of a general comment and Ruth, I dare say. I do think there's a couple of things I would want to say. I think first of all, this is a chance for us to look at the long term. I know we have to look at next year, but actually, when you're in a crisis like this, we do need to think about what we're doing in the long term and getting a political consensus around using taxes differently on that. That is the work we should be doing now. But in terms of the priorities, I absolutely agree. I think there's a lot of work on at the moment, some really hefty projects, and it's difficult, you know, that prioritisation exercise is very difficult, but I don't think I think we should be having that conversation about what is it that is going to really help us fulfil. How are we going to really work on child poverty? How are we going to not let that slip any further? I would say child poverty, but poverty overall. How are we going to do that? What could we not do at the moment without, because there's a lot of really good policies. The National Care Service is a good policy, but do we have the capacity to implement it in the way we're implementing at the moment? You know, I think there's a discussion to be had there, certainly in terms of, you know, expanding it out. There are other things we should be concentrating on to make sure what we're investing in is the preventative, the stuff that in the long term saves you from having to invest more money. So I think that's where the prioritisation exercise has to sit. I think we have to be brave about that, but I do think it's a discussion that had to be had.
So John's saying, Ruth, we should cut back on some areas of expenditure. What areas would you suggest?
The first point I want to come back on was the idea of the social security system being too generous. We'd push back on that in that I think the approach that the Scottish Government have taken to social security has been extremely welcome. We all rely on the social security safety net, but we know it's a vital lifeline for people who live on low incomes. When we look at the child poverty targets right now, as I said, we're not on track to meet those, but we know that the action that's been taken through the social security system, in particular the Scottish Child Payment, has done basically all of the heavy lifting in terms of helping us to get closer to those targets. So the Scottish Child Payment is expected to lift 90,000 children out of poverty, and we know that our members don't think that we've reached the end point of what we can do through the social security system in order to address poverty. I think on your point in terms of universalism versus targeting, I'm not going to sit there here today and say that that is a simple debate, because it's absolutely not. But when we look at the pros and cons of universalism versus targeted, we know that universal services are really important in terms of overcoming the impact of poverty-related stigma. We know that that functions as a barrier to uptake. I'm sure Adam will be able to talk about that in the context of pension credit. We also see that functioning as a barrier in the context of free school meals. Targeting was a theme that emerged from the First Minister's anti-poverty summit. But something that we would be concerned about is whether we have sufficient data, sufficient intersectional data in particular, to actually target resources and policies effectively. We know that there's tools within the budgetary process, so human rights budgeting and gender budget analysis, that help us to make sure that the budget is meeting the needs of those who need it most, but we're not routinely using those tools. The priority family approach is really important in the context of child poverty. 90% of children who experience poverty fall into at least one of those groups. But we don't have sufficient data about the experiences of poverty for those family groups, and we don't have sufficient data about how policies is meeting their needs. So if we are to go down a targeting approach, we need to make sure that that's being accompanied by the gathering and usage of robust equalities data to make sure that we are meeting the people that we say that we are intending to.
Okay, I think it'll be a theme that everyone will talk about areas where we spend more money in, but no one's going to actually say we should spend less in. Michael, to follow by Stuart.
Yeah, so can I take one step back into some of the question the convener was pushing on regarding, I suppose, your response around the tax rates was essentially that these jobs are sticky, that some, you know, and you believe that they are. But there's two other issues in that. I'm speaking to doctors yesterday, GP surgeries in Dundee yesterday, who was telling me that they in particular don't have a headcount problem. But nobody works 5 days, so they have a massive capacity problem, so they can't deliver. So that's a trend within the workforce anyway, and will changes in the differential tax rate and your work that you've done not impact on that? Is one thing. The other thing I've got problems with in Dundee is attracting breast cancer oncologists, and you'll know that breast cancer rates for the poorest of women are much, much worse than richer women, so this is actually about poor people. And that's an internationally competitive sector, and we're finding it really difficult to bring people to Scotland to do it. And so what modelling or consideration have you given to whether it's more likely that I get breast cancer oncologists in Dundee to help these women if we increase those tax rates?
Sorry, come back.
I don't know, who do you want to answer that?
Just any colleagues, but I think...
There's actually maybe something on John's question as well, so I'll try to take each of these in turn. So I'm not going to sit here today, albeit probably could, and say these are areas where you could save, and equally that debate about means testing universalism was one that rages on, but actually, I say it rages on, but I don't think we've ever really had a grown-up debate about it. It normally gets shouted down on either side. But I think, just to take one example, childcare. So it took years and really significant investment to get universal childcare for threes and fours. We are now looking at a commitment made at the start of this parliament to extend that to ones and twos, starting with the lowest income households, by the end of this parliament. So 5 years to extend that to ones and twos. They are the group, if you want to talk about particularly getting women back into the workplace, where you know is a huge problem, that is the group where a significant and generous funded offer, particularly for the lowest income households to help them get back into work to tackle poverty, would have been hugely beneficial. But we started with a universal offer at the upper age group and then decided to extend to at least to start with a means tested offer for younger ages, whereas actually, in probably the ideal world, what you would have done is gone, you know what, it's a difficult choice, but we're going to do a means-tested offer for 1 to 4 right now, and then we'll look to expand that to universal as resources and time and capacity allow. But we didn't do that. So I think it's one of those examples of where it doesn't have to be an either or. It's about how you phase, how you target, and how you ensure that you're using resources in the best possible way. But again, we almost did it back to front, upside down. And I think there's a separate point about where you put your money. And so this was, you literally just go and get a transcript of my comments at Health Committee this morning. Because we had a huge discussion in the pre-budget scrutiny around preventative spend. And it is one that more than a decade on from Christie is still an ambition rather than a reality. And I'm sure, I know Public Health Scotland said lots about this. But you look at those health projections, for example. So over the next 20 years, we know that Scotland's population is declining. But equally, the annual disease burden is increasing. And that's happening for two main reasons. One, in particular, we've got an ageing population. So again, we know that costs start to increase. But we're also getting sicker as a nation. And as a result, we're also getting poorer as a nation. But again, that is a large proportion of that is avoidable disease and ultimately actually avoidable mortality that if we had started to shift our resources much earlier, we could have prevented. So we did some analysis earlier this year looking at the economic and social harms of poverty. So just a couple of the highlights that we found in our analysis, we found that at least £2.3 billion of just health board funding is being directed towards responding to the cost of poverty. And then over and above that, we're losing at least £1.6 billion in economic contributions as a result of lower employment and lower output. So you can see the huge drag that poverty has on the economy. But again, because we've not shifted our resources at any point into prevention, and we're still quite often dealing with the consequences, whether that's in health, whether it's in social security, whether it's in any other public service, we deal with the consequences rather than tackling the root causes.
Phil, can you specifically answer Michael's point that he was concerned about how increasing taxes is going to
I knew there was three I had to come back on. I agree, and there's lots of quirks within the tax system that make it less than suboptimal. So, for example, I think it's been raised previously that you've got, as a result of the quirk of, and I'm going to call it a quirk because it is a quirk, and I don't think there are ways that you fix it. You've got a quirk of devolution whereby because now suddenly you've got an income tax system that is no longer aligned to a reserved national insurance system. You've got an instance where people, when they hit what is now the higher rate in Scotland, but you have not yet hit the higher rate at a UK level, their NIC contributions are still at the higher rate, whereas obviously they drop down to 2% when they hit the higher UK rate. So those people between about £44,000 and £50,000 actually have a much higher marginal tax rate than those who then hit 50, trigger the UK drop in the national insurance rate, and as such then their marginal tax rate comes down. So you've got quirks like this, which is why we've recommended that there should be a fundamental review, because we quite often just tweak. We'll either freeze rates, and we'll do that by, we'll bring people in by fiscal drag. We will, you know, I've already said it myself, we'll introduce new rates and bans. But there comes a point where you're just kind of adding more clunky bits into a system without recognising and responding to those quirks that exist within the devolution settlement and elsewhere in what that means for someone's marginal tax rate. So if you actually, what we've suggested is we need to go right back to scratch. We now recognise that we want to have a progressive system. I don't think you do that by just, for in the long term, adding in more rates and bans. We need to like start to rethink actually what does the tax system we need look like, and more importantly, where do those quirks and interactions come through with the reserve system?
Does that answer your question, Michael?
No. I suppose the two examples I used, Philip, I recognise they were jumping about a little bit. So it was about people reducing their hours.
All right.
So in the first instance, so GPs who are not working full-time and therefore massive capacity issues in GP surgeries, and that being a general trend, and whether the proposals you've put in place, you've thought about whether actually increasing those taxes would result in people reducing their hours. So key core services to help poor people in Scotland. And the other one was about attracting international talent, such as breast cancer surgeons in Tayside. I kind of want to get away from the stickiness side of it. I think that's right. But in this idea, but you know, we're looking towards trying to get somebody from internationally to come in, and whether we are going to prevent the NHS from being able to do that. Again, it's a key service for the poorest people in Scotland. And just whether you've done any work around the proposals you've put in place, is that those, the impact on those two issues?
So we haven't specifically, but there's lots of kind of economic analysis around how rational people are and whether or not people are rational actors and what they respond to. So actually the thing that people respond to most, in particular if we're talking about recruiting talent and attracting talent, I highly doubt that someone sitting in country A, B or C is looking at the tax system. What they are looking at is the salary on offer. Sorry, Liz, you may disagree. But in terms of attracting international talent, they are looking at the starting salary, so they are, and they're looking at what actually the compensation package is before, and they may then get to it, before they get into a consideration of then what that means in terms of a starting salary in a UK or Scottish tax system and a starting salary in a French or Australian tax system. So that's the attracting talent. The retaining or the potential to reduce ours. Again, like that is all part of the behavioural responses. And again, people can be irrational in terms of how they respond to those changes. Again, it's as much about pay and rewards and compensation and burnout, actually, in particular in the health service. Again, someone reducing their hours in the health service is probably at much risk of doing that as a result of burnout and demand as they are as a result of the tax system. So I don't, I'm not answering your question probably in the way that you want, because I'm not convinced there's a satisfactory black or white answer.
Yeah, I'm sure there isn't. There definitely isn't. But I mean, our previous evidence session, Professor David Hale talked about people negotiating around their net pay position. So in essence, agreeing with you, and that somebody internationally is going to look at that, whether it's coming out through tax or it's coming through a lower basic wage, is probably immaterial to somebody making that move internationally. Does that then not result in the NHS having to pay more, substantially more, to make up for the cuts, and then actually it becomes a bit of a vicious cycle where the public sector has to pay, in, on your logic, into the system rather than actually gaining?
I think, well, it's a separate discussion about pay, and indeed lots of the projections that are showing increasing health spend, they're primarily being driven by increasing pay awards, so they are. So pay is going to go up in one way or the other in the health service, so it is. There's potentially a question about the extent to which it goes up to compensate for those effects, as opposed to just general awards that you would expect. But we definitely know that pay pressures are increasing in the health service.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, Stuart, you've been very patient.
Okay, I'm going to try and answer a question about areas where we could maybe not spend some money. And I think transport is one area in terms of our priorities there, and some of the road building schemes, such as the A9, £3 billion. That's a lot of money, and it could do a lot of good elsewhere. That's not to say you shouldn't spend some money there, but if you want to get road safety benefits, you can get them for a lot less. So we need to look at these types of projects. And I think transport in itself can start to fund itself if we're a little bit smarter about it. And I'd give one example. When you put any bit of transport infrastructure in, the land value uplifts, that's just straight profit to whoever's building on that land. We don't capture that very well through the planning system. So we could do that fairly quickly. There's been attempts to do that, but we need to have a national system on that. And the other area is parking. We give parking away for free in a lot of towns. And, you know, councils say they're skint, but they still can give parking away for free. And I think they need to think about, well, what could we do with that money for that community rather than subsidising parking.
Yeah, there was a bit of a backlash in my area when it was suggested that parking be priced, actually, so, and the council actually changed its policy on that. I mean, one of the things that came out of the last session, Stuart, was road pricing, and it was... And I mean, how do you actually achieve that without impacting adversely on rural communities, for example? I mean, would you only have road pricing in urban areas, for example, or in motorways? Or how would you get around that? Because quite clearly, Scotland is, for many people, rural communities are very fragile and they don't really have any alternative to car. You can talk about public transport all you like, but whether you increase, you know, the bus service for twice a day, three or four times a day, isn't going to make much odds to some people. And the car will remain essential for a number of people in our communities.
I think we need to look at urban areas and rural areas separately. And I think we need to look at, as our economists say, the whole system in terms of what people pay overall. And I think there is obviously a compensation mechanism needed within road pricing to make sure that these rural communities aren't penalised. I think that the technology and the systems are available to do that, but we do have a target to reduce traffic in Scotland. And at the moment, we're kind of not doing anything on a fiscal sense to actually achieve that. And we won't achieve that. And we'll have all sorts of negative consequences, which will impact on the NHS. They will cost money in terms of road deaths, road casualties, the consequences of air pollution. And probably the biggest one we don't talk about in terms of the NHS is the cost of inactivity, where people just don't get out and about because there's too much traffic in their communities and they don't feel safe. And that impacts on our old people, especially if they're not walking, they're not getting the strength and balance, they're then more likely to pick up a condition that's a long-term condition that costs the NHS a lot of money.
Okay. Adam, to follow by Judith.
Thank you, Convener. I'm not going to your despair give you a list of things to cut just now, but it was to John Mason's point. I wish I could. It's because it's quite complex, actually, if you think about the budget process. It's not that transparent. We're looking at budget lines that come out that are, you know, billions of pounds, and the kind of the decimal points or the rounding error kind of element of this is vast, vast amounts of money, which can in themselves pay for massive projects such as, you know, the National Concessionary Travel Card. And one thing, and I suppose my bit around this is about universality. And for 20 plus years, Scotland has gone down this path of making things free for as many people as possible and hugely popular with the public. And on the face of it, you know, you're looking at, well, this, the bus pass, for instance, maybe cost £250 million or now more than that with younger people rightly having access to that. But what are the other benefits to this and also for the long term? And I remember actually, Convener, probably a couple of years ago, you tried to skewer me in a sense to suggest that the 60-year-old free bus pass should become 65, of which our former chief executive was delighted at 59 not to have succeeded in the ground. But the point is that we're looking to the future as well for these things when you've got a quarter of people who are between 55 and state pension age who are living in poverty in Scotland, most likely to be women, most likely to be carers. And that just because you have a bus pass, for instance, I'm using bus pass as one example, doesn't mean you can use it. And your point, Convener, about rural Scotland, you know, we'll speak to lots of older people who would love to use that entitlement but just can't. That the connectedness that they'll have as a result of access to some kind of transport means that their lives are better, the public health challenges are less severe, that they can take part in social fabric activities such as volunteering, childcare, lots of different things. So the point is, and that's really what I'm coming to, is that your job is enviable, actually, because every single year I have the same challenge, is that we've got huge amount of priorities for the country, that they're getting more severe, and the wriggle room in terms of funding these things is going to be really, really tough. So I think the universal thing is an important point, and Ruth sort of alluded to the fact that there are so many people, even when you have a very, very low income, eligibility, don't claim pension credit. Well, it's not within this Parliament and the Scottish Government's remit just now, is a third to 40% of those who are entitled to it don't claim it, whether it's through stigma, whether it's through inaccessibility, digital exclusion, didn't even know it existed in the first place, the system fighting against them. So as soon as you create a system whereby there is a line, it's very, very inaccessible. And there's never been a discussion of what is that line? What is the line of the deserving person? Because I've been to many cost of living events for MSPs and MPs over the last 18 months, and more often than not, old people come up to me and say, my income is £10,000 a year. What is there for me? And the answer is nothing. You're just over pension credit level, and that's it. The line is somewhere, but it's absolutely devastating. And if 42% of pensioners in Scotland don't even have enough income to pay income tax, so under £12,500 a year, it demonstrates across our society we've got a huge number of people who are really struggling. And this is, I suppose, a challenge for the future as well. So this is not, I'm not bearing good news, and here's all the things you can cut, but actually thinking about all of these pots of money are very much interlinked. But the real challenge is here is how is that money spent? Like, how is it spent well? The transparency you have as a committee or the Parliament onto future spends as well, and that multi-year question that we've had before is really, really important, so that we're not in a position where, and maybe it's necessary because of the politics, of political giveaways, election purposes or otherwise, or commitments, and some things are not realised or not. So it's a really challenging position, but the idea that we've just got some easy fixes and is challenging, and we've got a lot of people looking at council tax, a good example that's in the news just now, but how regressive that is to increase those in the highest tax bands because of the nature of why they're identified to be there in the first place. What we don't look at this is not just about wealth, and it's not to disagree really with IPR or Poverty Alliance, and this is what we don't measure is someone's ability to pay, liquidity. And if we're looking at just wealth, for instance, in capital in a house, well, to pay for that tax, then you might have to sell your home, but you don't have anywhere else to go. I mean, also not forgetting the social care system, most people interact with the social care system, particularly residential care homes, having to use their homes to pay for social care. So if that goes, then your ability to pay for social care is depleted. And indeed, now we've got the social care contract is nowhere near enough to actually meet the need when you've run out of money. So all these challenges are interlinked. I don't think it's a very easy, like, stop this, do that. But I think it's part of how your transparency of how is that money being spent well in the future, and how can we prove that preventive spending will help the lowest incomes in the future, because our population is ageing, of course it is. And even if we had more younger people, we'll still have more and more older people. And not to David Bell's point about getting closer to death is going to cost more, whether you feel that or not. Everyone's life is a little bit different, depending where you are, whether it's your constituency convener and like kind of low income or health chance there too. So I've gone on a bit of a rant there, I know, but the point is about, I don't think you do have simple switch on, switch off, and actually the knock-on impact of that switch off might mean that you spend more money later on. So for instance, delayed discharge means that people, £140 million a year in that, but actually the care needs and health needs as a result of being in hospital for a week or 2 weeks is much more than that £262 a day in hospital. So they're very, very complicated questions that you're asking. And
yeah, I mean, I think there's a couple of points. Well, first of all, in terms of the issue about lowering the bus pass age from 65 to 60, that was a suggestion that came not from me, but from Age Scotland in the 11 to 16 Parliament from Callum Chomchuk. Yep. And he said the money saved should be spent on adaptations for older people. So Age Scotland were actually at that time saying, you know, we think this is... And I thought it was very brave, because so many people come here... you know, not mentioning the names, not looking at anyone specifically, saying, oh, aye, we should spend more money on this, but not how we can save money on that. And I think we have, as a committee, and the Scottish Government has to look at that. But what John Swinney then did was he says, no, I'm not going to reduce the age from 65 to 60, but we'll increase the disabled adaptations budget by 25%. So there was a win, really, a big win there for Age Scotland. In terms of the thing you touched on, in terms of people, you know, having to sell their homes, you know, not just for wealth tax, but for going into... residential care home. I mean, this affected my mother and many other people. And I was speaking to a leading economist who has a good relationship with this committee, and he said two of his aunties just said, you know what, rather than going to a care home and see the house getting sold, we're just going to go on a world cruise for the next couple of years and spend the money that way. And it wasn't a flippant remark, because that's what they actually did, because there are some people who, of course, aren't able to save up and buy a house, but they don't then have an asset to sell. But people who feel that they've got an asset that they might want to, you know, pass on at least in part to their children are unable to do so. So there's a real issue there about the fairness in that. I mean, one of the things that people talk about, I should say, I don't know if anyone wants to try and define it for me, but is fairness. And I think fairness for one person is maybe fairness for another. Anyway, I'm starting to wander off as well. So the next person to ask a question will be Judith. Sorry, or comment will be Judith, to be followed by Michael Kellett.
Mine was quite some time ago, but I just very quickly would like to reflect back on what are the incentives that make people want to work somewhere. And I do think that's quite important, because I work in a sector where people are not incentivised by money. We are trying to get to a state where we're paying people fairly. And again, that's a good question, what is fair, but where people are paid appropriately. But we're never going to be in it for like the big bucks. And I see that in lots of different realms of life. People make decisions, not just they do make decisions based on salary, and that's important. But if we create a society where people come here for other reasons, that might not, you know, you might not immediately attract your breast cancer specialist, but they will be coming for the package, but not just the package that they're getting from the hospital, but the package that they get when their child goes to school, and the package that they get because they'll be looked after when they're old, and all these different things. So I think just it's a very simplistic, well, I know that's not what you're saying, but like, money is not the only driver in terms of what the decisions people make, what they do. And in fact, it's very often the secondary or the tertiary or, you know, the bottom driver, certainly in my experience of my...
Chicken and egg, is it not? I mean, if the economy doesn't grow and we're not able to attract more investment because people feel that there will be tax disproportionately high, then you're not going to have the money to provide these services. So, you know, Scotland could become more of a backwater, more young people will leave, etc. Population will stagnate or decline, with the lowest population growth in the entire world in the 20th century. For example, you know, 2 million emigrated in a half century after the war alone. So there are real issues to address in terms of that that whole package, and it's about trying to get the optimum right, not the maximum or the minimum, but the optimum, so that we can actually achieve what I think most of us want to achieve. Anyway, Michael, to be followed by Alistair.
Thanks very much, Convener. Really welcome the opportunity to be here today. I'm not a tax expert at all, Convener, so I won't attempt to answer the committee's very sensible questions, but I agree with Adam. I think this is a really difficult challenge. The one thing I wanted to make clear, and it might surprise the committee, Convener, is that I'm not here making the case today for a bigger slice of the pie for the NHS and for the health and social care budget. The pressures on the NHS are very real, and Mr Mara talked about some of those, but there are many right across the country, and one of the things we are prioritising in Public Health Scotland is working with our patient-facing boards to deal with these pressures. But the reason I'm not making a case for a bigger slice of the pie is because, as I think it was Professor Heald says, we recognise that investment in health services doesn't equate to improvements in health. And the committee will have heard before, I'm sure, but the estimates, and this is based on King's Fund, is that in terms of the health services contribution to health of the nation, only about 20% of the health is caused by that investment of health services. 50% is about the building blocks of health, about the social and economic factors, about the physical environment that people live in. That's why the case that Public Health Scotland want to make today, conveners, for preventative investment, and particularly primary preventative investment. And partly to answer some of the questions we heard, and I think this is one of your stats, Philip, that research you published earlier this year, but the failure demand caused by poverty alone within the NHS, the estimate is it causes 2.3 billion of spending of the £19 billion total spend on health and social care services. So that gives you some estimate, and that I think will be an underestimate of the total failure demand of the impact of not investing preventatively. The other point I wanted to make, Convener, that we've not covered today perhaps, is that I think there is something about sustained collaboration across public services and the third and private sector towards shared goals with improved health and wellbeing at its heart. And that's why, Convener, in this context, we in Public Health Scotland really welcome the review of the National Performance Framework. We think that's really important. We welcome the Verity House agreement, that kind of parity between national and local government, recognition of needing to work very closely. We've heard about the challenges in terms of local government funding and the fact that they control so many of the social and economic building blocks I've just talked about. We also welcome the thinking around the wellbeing and future generations bill, learning from experience in Wales of the future generations commissioner. And effectively that for me is around systematising a long-term and preventative approach to how we think about public spending in Scotland. And our submission to you, Convener, would be that in terms of scrutiny of the budget this year and future years would be something that the committee should pay attention to. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. Alistair, in your submission you talked about research and development in Scotland still punching well above its weight, so 13.5% compared to 8.2% of the population, but that's also down from about 15.7% just a few years ago. So can you talk to us about how important that is and about how important the university sector is to Scotland's economic growth, wealth and prosperity?
Thank you very much. Very welcome to have that opportunity. Declaring an interest, as well as being Director of University of Scotland, I'm also a board member of the Scottish Council for Development and Industry, and some of my perspectives reflect that role as well. And I think, you know, critically, when you're talking about the sustainability of Scotland's finances, from a university perspective, and we believe that we are drivers of inclusive growth and productivity, and that is absolutely key to the sustainability of Scotland's finances, and indeed to creating the prosperity that lets us invest in making sure that we're looking after the most vulnerable in society. So, I think what we're doing in investing in a high skills economy is incredibly important. I was talking to colleagues in the Republic of Ireland just a couple of weeks ago, saying they're much faster bounce back
from the 2008 financial crash was largely based on their very high skills availability, very high level of graduates in the population, and ability to attract foreign direct investment on the basis of that. And they have bounced back a lot faster than us, I think, with that being one of their advantages. Graduates create growth. Graduates bring skills to the economy. They create tax growth by generating a virtuous cycle of high skills, more productive employment, and are also motors of social inclusion, because we're in universities and colleges are drawing more and more people in from the most disadvantaged backgrounds and creating opportunity. We're getting more people into positions where they're actually utilising all their talents and contributing effectively to tax revenue. Likewise, on research and innovation, there's lots of economic studies. We reckon there's about an 8-to-1 economic multiplier from investment in research and innovation, because what that does is it draws in competitively won resources from UK, from international sources, from business. It creates talent attraction. The research and innovation projects we're doing are drawing people in from across the world to Scotland to create real clusters of innovation and economic growth. I mean, looking at Michael Maris here, looking around Dundee, I mean, I think the contribution of life sciences based around university there to generating a huge cluster of businesses around that and revitalising Dundee has been absolutely fundamental. We do a huge amount for supporting businesses, consultancy and SMEs, continuing professional development, working with tens of thousands of businesses a year. And also on the capital side, we talked in the first session about the importance of capital expenditure. There's a sort of artificiality for us that research and innovation is actually classified as capital, so we need that capital to keep coming. But there's also, at the sort of more concrete end of that, we are trying to maintain an ageing, largely 1960s, 1970s estate, and there are huge opportunities there for creating that pipeline that the economists are talking about of confidence in capital investment by having projects that renew that estate, that make it more green and effective. And, last time we got a one-off investment from Scottish Government in a year of 40 million, we tracked where that got spent. 90% of that got spent in Scottish businesses just coming in and doing the work. I think there's huge opportunities in lifelong learning as well, and what we can do and what I think generally should be invested in to help people upskill and reskill throughout their lives, so that people are continually able to refine what they bring for their own satisfaction and for work. So that my plea, looking at this through the lens of sustainability of Scotland's finances, is invest where you know you're going to get a return on investment in terms of creating that sustainable, green, inclusive economic growth that then gives you the resources to address the many challenges that are facing society.
Indicated they're going to commence. I'll make a couple of comments. I mean, I think that what's been done in Dundee with life sciences and gaming is quite phenomenal. I think that Scotland really is on a global map in terms of its universities and its knowledge economy. I think that's important. But have you ever tried to get a roofer or a plumber or an electrician these days? I mean, I think there's a real issue about the balance about people going to university and not going to university, and that we talk about building houses, et cetera, for example, the importance of affordable housing, but there's a chronic shortage right across the construction industry because, sadly, some schools, and I've certainly found this in my own area, are some teachers within some schools, I should say, are saying to children that you're a bit of a failure if you don't go to university. And so people who would go into apprentices and probably have really good careers and highly skilled careers are not doing so, and we have chronic skill shortages in some of these very basic, not very basic skills, but engineering, for example, construction skills, etc. So where do we strike the balance? Because I think what we need and what we want in Scotland is for our universities to remain cutting edge, but what about the rest of the economy? What about the situation whereby we apprentices are perhaps not being valued as much, and therefore we're not getting enough people in that? And of course, without those basic skills to support the universities and other sectors of the economy, we can't grow as well as we would.
One of the things, sorry, I believe personally strongly, I think it's shared across my membership, is a belief that there's no wrong path, that actually There should genuinely be parity of esteem between the various pathways that, people can choose, and that, you know, there need to be as valuable pathways for people from university when they leave school. May not be the right answer, maybe the right answer to them later in their careers, but it's not the right answer for everybody when they leave school, and that we've got to have a really high quality offering across the whole range of people's talents and aspirations. I think that comes out very, very strongly from the Withers review. I would actually just say, coming back to the capital point, if we keep a sustained pipeline of capital investment in infrastructure, as well as that contributing to total factor productivity, it creates the confidence that these industries are actually going to invest in the throughput of talent, in the apprenticeships, and actually, you know, building and confidence from people that there are sustainable careers in construction and in engineering that aren't going to be boom and bust because there is this sustained pipeline of capital projects to employ them.
Okay, I mean, I think part of it seems really important, and I think I would certainly endorse your comments on that. 2 years ago, John Mason pointed out, when you gave evidence at Glasgow University, cash assets of, I think, £770 million. So, I mean, surely if the universities, and of course you did point out at that point that not all universities are quite as well off as Glasgow was at that time, and I don't know if they still are as well off. John's probably got a better grip on those accounts than I have. But surely the university sector, at least Glasgow, has got plenty of money themselves to invest without seeking additional resources from a public sector, which, as we've heard, is already constrained.
It's an incredibly varied picture across the sector, but one where I think some of the high levels of what appeared to be assets were actually reflecting high levels of borrowing that were then being invested in things like the transformation of Glasgow's West End, and that will bring huge economic benefit to Glasgow. I mean, it really is going to be transformational for the West End and for the university's impact. So it's a good investment to do. It will have that broader economic return. But I think generally, you know, universities, I talk to my members a lot, are feeling the strain of having to do research and the teaching of Scottish domiciled students at a level that is far below the actual economic cost of what they're doing. I mean, we've seen erosions of about a third in teaching and research funding in real terms since 2014-15. The pips are starting to squeak across the sector. Everyone does what they can to provide the best quality experience to students, but they're coming forward with greatly increased needs post-pandemic. We even saw it during that pandemic, the increased needs. And so it's a real, you know, talking to my members, it's differential in different places, but there is a real, real stretch of trying particularly to meet students' increased welfare and learning needs post-pandemic on a diminishing teaching resource.
I was talking to one economics professor who we're talking about the number of people that are economically inactive, and that includes students who are not unemployed, despite what the Daily Mail said in their front page a week or so ago. But what he suggested was, and I thought it was an interesting suggestion to at least look at, is that, you know, we could do as well with a three-year degree in Scotland as a four-year degree, given the three-year degree south of the border. How do you feel about that? And what would be the impact on the cost base of the university, et cetera, from that? And how would it free up resources? It would certainly mean that people leave university a year early and are able to contribute to the workforce a year early.
I think the way we like to look at the four-year degree, and obviously, you know, degrees of different length, is increasingly as a flexible spine with different entry and exit points. Now, I think the problem about, in some sense, trying to standardise that to a three-year degree is actually it requires fundamental re-engineering of what you do at school. I mean, we essentially have a four-year degree because we've got hires as the general entry qualification. Most schools can't offer a wide range of advanced hires, and many learners really need the time over the course of a senior phase to develop their full talents and develop their full portfolio of hires. So for as long as hires are the normal entry requirement for university, you need to start a year lower than you do with people who've done A-levels in England, because you've basically got a year's less content. So if you're going to be serious about looking at shortening the university degree, you would actually have to be making parallel investment in schools to make sure that people were routinely able to get up to what's currently advanced higher level. I think the other, you know, there are lots of other considerations, not least workforce considerations, but also a lot of our degrees are accredited by professional regulatory bodies, so you need to do the full course to make sure that you're qualified to enter the professions, and that's not something that, that you can unilaterally abbreviate.
I'm not sure it's something on the immediate horizon, but it's just one thing I wanted to throw into the mix. Stuart's going to come in, but Michael, you want to make a comment on universities first.
I appreciate that, Camilla. I mean, Alistair, you know that I'm a big supporter of the universities in Dundee, and we've had those conversations regularly, but you'll also be aware that we have industrial action this week. Various institutions across the country, Unite are out, UCU are out, looking for pay that's actually commensurate to something approaching the cost of living, frankly. I mean, how can we make sure that our universities are delivering the pay deals that we require, given that we're sitting here talking about budgets?
Candidly, I think we all recognise around the table that there are difficulties in industrial relations and universities at the moment. My point of view would be that those are symptomatic of a system under stress. Whether it's the collective UK level negotiations through University and College Employers Association, or whether it's the individual institutional negotiations, they're all taking place against the background of real severe financial stress in the institution, with the constant real terms diminution of core funding, and also with, I think, an increasing feeling of risk that the one-way bet that we've been essentially led towards of relying on international students to try and cover the losses that are being sustained elsewhere is starting to look a lot more vulnerable than it did. I mean, I think the markets that were expanding, Pakistan, Nigeria, for instance, the change in rules on where you can bring dependents are actually reducing those markets. I'm actually speaking to my members, just walking the beat. People are saying they're actually quite worried about some of the international students who accepted offers not turning up because they've chosen to take up an offer at a different university in a different system. We all want industrial harmony, but I think the background to some of the difficulties there are at the moment is that genuine stress in the system, including the worry that we've got this one-way bet on international students, who are great, obviously, for our educational cultural diversity, but shouldn't be the pillar on which the sustainability of our system is resting on its own.
Thank you. Stuart?
Follow up on the point about pipelines and the capital sector. I think that's really important, but I think also right across public and third sector, the idea of annualised budgets is becoming more and more difficult. We're learning later and later when we've got money to deliver projects, and that has massive implications in terms of staffing, gearing up, gearing down, and it's costing a lot of money. And if you're doing that every year as opposed to doing it every 3 years, you've got three times the cost in terms of all the scrutiny that goes into that. And we're in the position where we're planning for next year. We run a schools programme. The schools are only back six weeks, and we're already sort of starting to work at what we've done, we're going to do for next year. So we need to start to do things on a little bit of a long-term basis to actually see some data coming through and allowing us to do some evaluation. It's really, really painful right across all the public sector in terms of the way we're doing this.
Okay, no comment on that then. Adam, I'm going to ask you something, and I'm going to put the same kind of question to IPPR, basically, Poverty Alliance. I mean, what you've said in your submission is you've talked about it's important to have fair and multi-year funding, comprehensive investment and support provided by organisations, such as community organisations, is needed. The continued delivery of significant funding programmes and activities which connect people, such as older people's groups, is crucial, and we'd also like to see appropriate resourcing to address and reduce excessive waits for healthcare. The issue about that I'm going to ask you and others is how much are we talking about? Because it's one thing to say appropriate resourcing, or we need to spend more, or we need to make significant investment, but we're obviously trying to take evidence on the 24-25 budget to try and have an impact on what the Scottish Government's decision-making processes will be. So what, basically, additional resources are we talking about, and how specifically would that be funded?
So to continue my theme of being unhelpful with this decision, convener. But what I mean, this it's a bit elastic, really. I mean, what the point about this is that, particularly sort of leading here to Stuart's point about kind of multi-year funding or kind of timescales, like you can actually get much more return on the investment on a three-year funding. So take a charity sector organisation, a programme on that year, because you're taking a year funding, you're taking time out of delivering something to go and account for what you've done, to evaluate it, to go through a lot of scrutiny for sometimes modest amounts of money. And one of the things that we found, particularly with response to the COVID-19 pandemic, is where community organisations, charities and whatnot can do a heck of a lot with not very much in the grand scheme of things. One great example of this, for instance, looking at how the community groups is, I'm grateful to the Scottish Government for this, but they gave us £200,000 at the beginning of this year to distribute to old people's groups across the country to help them keep the doors open, because 200,000 older people across Scotland rely on local groups, local activity groups, to keep them connected, keep them fed, keep them warm, keep them all of these things that are really, really important. But actually, some groups are coming back, £500 will actually keep us operating for the rest of the year. And without that, these folks are staying in their own homes. They've probably got a higher burden on health challenges. They can't afford their energy bills to begin with. So there's lots of kind of knock-on impacts. So the point of this is not, I know it's not particularly helpful, but some of this is about how long you get to go and deliver it, to get some kind of guarantees so you can actually use your staff time when you've got it effectively on delivering things for people. And I think part of this is about the scrutiny that the charity sector, for instance, has on public funding is significant, that the evaluation processes are good, but they're also time-consuming. But at the same point, on big public sector projects, to what degree of scrutiny happens there as well, it's commensurate. Some of the point here is that not very much goes a long way, and we've looked at loneliness and isolation funding that initially was, at the beginning of this Parliament, suggested people think it was £10 million, but in reality it's more like £5 million has gone into it, and that's been kind of cut away in different spending reviews. But you know, you're looking at big projects that cost billions of pounds, and this is millions or hundreds of thousands of pounds, but the knock-on impact bang for the buck is significant. So I know that's not particularly helpful, but the idea of the multi-year funding
helps. It's helpful to an extent, because it does help focus on this. A number of people, including the economists that were here before, have talked about the three-year funding or perhaps 5 years, and obviously we know the Scottish Government isn't funded beyond year to year, but there's still an issue about whether or not we should plan. And I have to say that I was in the Social Justice Committee in the 1990-2003 Parliament. We produced a detailed report on why we should do exactly what you've suggested. 20-odd years later, we're still talking about it. So I think that is actually a fundamental point, although you haven't put pounds, shillings and pence on it. So I'm just wondering if, because you have got some statistical analysis in terms of your report, Ruth, whereby you've produced some wonderful graphs, etc., etc. So I'm wondering if you can talk us through maybe in a few short minutes, what exactly, what additional resources you think we should be, you know, given all the caveats about wealth tax, you know, we kind of be implemented for the next financial year, et cetera, et cetera, according to the economists. But what we could do in the next year in order to deliver the agenda that yourself and the IPPR and indeed some others would like to see.
Yeah, no problem. I would say that Philip next to me is the maths man, so I will let him speak through some of those tables. But I think that the things that we would be calling for in order to end poverty are, of course, costly, and we recognise that. Ahead of Challenge Poverty Week, which takes place between the 2nd and the 8th of October, and I'm sure is in everybody's diaries around this table, we've called for a series of policy changes around the minimum income guarantee, housing and transport, and we recognise that those are costly. I think the picking up on Adam's points about the fair funding for the third sector, that's another one of our key calls this year. As you say, convener, that's a long-standing call from the Scottish Government to actually recognise the value of the third sector with multi-year funding awards that are fair and sustainable. We would echo SCVO's calls around fair funding and think that that's really important, particularly because during the cost of living crisis, we know that some of our community-based membership have really been at the front line of efforts to tackle poverty, and we think that they should be recognised with fair funding. But current trackers from SCVO show that around two-thirds of the third sector are facing financial challenges. I think for us, we have looked at the modelling in terms of what we could raise with the changes that we are proposing around tax. Of course, these are just options, but looking at setting that that higher rate of income tax, that new tax band, could raise between £110 and £260 million, depending on where you set that. Obviously, in the longer term, around £300 million from setting that inheritance tax at the local level.
First figure's assuming no behavioural impact, is it?
Yes, I presume in the modelling we have not accounted for behavioural impact, but I'm sure that Philip is able to come back on that as well. And also £350 million from looking at changes to council tax as well. I think for us, it's also not solely about new money, but also thinking about the way in which that we approach the budget process. I've already highlighted things like human rights budgeting and a gender budget analysis. And when we're in economic crisis and when budgets are particularly tight, it's even more important that we are undertaking those analyses to make sure that we're making the most of the resources that we have. I really like the turn of phrase that the Alliance used in their contribution around human rights being the golden thread that runs through everything that the Parliament does. And it's really important that when committees are undertaking their budget scrutiny, that we're not thinking that equality budget analysis or human rights budget analysis should only take place in the Equalities and Human Rights Committee. That should be a priority for all of the committees. And that's really one of the key ways in which we can make sure that we're maximising our resources when we are in a very tight fiscal environment.
Anything you want to add then, Phil?
Yeah, I think just on where it goes, I'm not sure it'll be much more helpful. But I suppose your starting point for 24-25, if that's where your primary interest in, is minus £1 billion. So that's the central estimate of kind of resource spending requirements to commitments. So you start with minus £1 billion. Then your next step is, well, does money we have, are we meeting the big commitments we've set? So you go to resource spending review, you go to programme for government, look at the three big ones. NHS recovery, we know the targets yet in the NHS recovery plan to get elective backlogs under control aren't being met yet across both inpatients and outpatients. So that's not being met. You then look at child poverty. Current projections say the interim child poverty target next year is not going to be met. So that's not being met. And you look at climate change. At the minute, again, climate change targets are not being met. So in terms of where your money is going, if you start with minus one billion, even on the current spending commitments, it's not meeting those three really big commitments that the Scottish Government has set itself. So that clearly says you need to relook again at your spending to ensure that you are diverting all resources to being able to meet those, if you think those are the three big ones. So I'm not sure I've got any specifics right. Well, I could have some specifics right now to say where to put it. But I suppose at a conceptual level, those seem to be the three big areas. And with minus £1 billion, there's going to need to be some difficult decisions that are taken to actually start to see money being put towards those. Which I think leads on to the two other things. One, we're still not very good at outcomes-based budgeting. Quite often our position is still, this is how much money we have, so we'll put it into this, rather than how much money does this require to actually tackle it. We quite often talk about the MPF being our North Star. I always torture a metaphor and say, if I get lost, I can follow the North Star, but I still might fall off the edge of a cliff because I don't know how, I'm following it, but I still don't know where I'm going. We're still not very good at actually determining what are the things that we are changing in pursuit of those quite large-scale national outcomes. We're not there yet. And then finally, multi-year spends. We didn't get a spending review for a decade, and then the one that we did get last year obviously only gave us level two figures. I think there's something in that for me. At a level two, you either need to know what your level three assumptions are, and so another level down, you know what has roughly made up that assumption of what the spending review level two figures are, or what you've done is arrive at a level two figure with not actually much idea of what that means for individual spends at a programme level beneath that. So we clearly need more detail if we're going to do a spending review and for it to actually have purpose in being able to aid long-term understanding of where we're putting our money and what that means in terms of long-term outcomes.
Okay, before I let you in, Ruth, Jamie and Ross are keen to come in.
Thanks very much. I mean, it was actually just along the kind of points that have been made there. Government, I think, is very good at saying, this is how much we spent rather than this is the outcome of what we've spent. We've been talking about kind of multi-year funding. One of the issues isn't just about how many years it's got to take. Even when we've seen projects that have had extended deadlines, it's because the criteria hasn't been set up in the right way. So, for example, on the rural and islands housing funds, the year-long year-long process that was meant to take was extended, but the money still hasn't been utilised. So I'm just wondering how important the government getting that criteria right in the first instance is, because if we have limited budget, we have to make sure they're being used, and too much of it at the moment seems to be being underutilised.
I would echo that in that particular area specifically, because I've raised that myself. Ross?
Thanks. Just to follow up on what Ruth just mentioned there, I suppose it's probably a question for Philip as well, and a point of clarification. I'm broadly very sympathetic to the tax proposals that you've laid out, but on the question of the local inheritance tax, my understanding of the current settlement is that we're allowed to create new local taxes, but not if they replicate an existing national tax. So something like a local inheritance tax or local capital gains tax would be out with the current devolution settlement. The UK government wouldn't allow that because it replicates something that already operates UK-wide. But obviously that's in your proposal. So do you have a different understanding of what is currently within scope?
What we did there, we never gone into it at that level of detail. So even the Scotland Act itself, obviously it's new local taxes for the purposes of funding local revenue. So what the proposals on our paper were, they were not meant to be intended as kind of, this is it, job done. I think what it was meant to be is, you know, there's been lots of discussion around wealth taxes at Scottish Government level and beyond, without any substantive detail of what that could start to look like, as much as anything was meant to be a start, you know, a helpful contribution to starting that conversation of, you know, the local tax powers you have are probably one of the most substantial, given national tax powers are restricted to income tax. So if you wanted to start using those as a means, what could you do? So it wasn't meant to be definitive, very much just as a, here are some initial suggestions.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you for that. The last person to comment will be Adam. He's the only person who's actually down to comment at the moment. And then what we'll do is we'll have a 1 minute for each of our guests to wind up and say anything which perhaps has not been covered so far that they want to go over to the committee. So, Adam.
Thanks, Avina. It's just a response.
You'll be a minute after this, by the way.
Thanks. I'll try and keep it to a minute or so. Jamie Halko-Johnson's point there about the programmes that are set up, and one of the things I'd recognise here is we, on budget terms, have hundreds of millions of pounds that are to spend on energy efficiency programmes in Scotland, but the mechanism for spending that and for giving it out to households has been closed between spring and autumn this year because of the change in the contract and who delivers this. You think about the best time to fix your roof is when the rain isn't pouring. Well, this is the moment. It's to your point about how we spend the money, not just the headline figures, and there could be savings there in terms of what's not spent. But it goes back to one of the points about industry, and Alistair Sims' point about investing in things that return money, is we've got energy efficiency, net zero things, but actually we've got an industry in making our homes low carbon, that we had an industry, in a sense, I know we spoke in the past about, you know, Interlink fire and smoke alarms. We fundamentally couldn't structurally deliver that to the right number of homes for such low amount of money in a good amount of time. So actually thinking ahead on hundreds of millions of pounds investment that isn't going to the right place at the right time and where the low-hanging fruit is to get more homes who are in fuel poverty out of fuel poverty and targeting them. Smart use of data as part of our systems for those people on the lowest incomes, go to them first, make their homes warmer, more secure, and actually there'll be sort of economic benefit in multiple ways as well. So I think the point there is just about, I think it's a smart point, but the programmes are set up, not just the high-level money, but how you spend it or not, and what happens to that money afterwards actually is a bit black hole.
Okay, a minute or so to wind up. Judith.
Yes, well, thanks. That was very interesting, and it's been a delight to be here. I think I've actually learnt very much. I think really the key points for me are around that piece of prioritising prevention, you know, not using the crisis to take money away from that, just to run along with the things that it's very tempting in a crisis to do that. I think that whole point about outcomes budgeting, we're not good enough about that, so we're actually tending to fund the activity that you can measure rather than what are the long-term outcomes we're looking for, which I know is easy to talk about, more difficult to implement, but I think we just need to seriously start putting some effort and energy into that. I think we need to invest in the long term. I was going to come in a wee bit earlier about that multi-year thing. The unintended consequences of short-term funding are immeasurably inefficient, both for the civil servants who are managing them, as well as for the people, whether it be whoever's receiving money, whether it's you know, whether it's third sector or not. It leads to an industry of creating grant proposals, getting money, and actually not doing the work. So actually getting rid of that inefficiency will actually free up a awful lot of time, and I think that's something that we can all do, and sometimes less money, but you know you've got it for a long time, will actually do much more good than a chunk of money that you can't, that you've got a year to spend, and then you can't sometimes spend it because you run out of time to actually be able to do that. So I think getting rid of that inefficiency would be great, and I'll stop because I'm sure there's lots of other
okay.
things.
Stuart. I just mentioned the active travel spend in the budget, which has been hugely positive. It's approaching 10%, I think. But the good thing about that was it was a longer-term commitment over the course of a parliament. I think that's the way to go, is to give time to gear up, and even that's proved quite challenging. Another area where spending will get you a lot of value is buses. We have a native bus industry, manufacturing industry in this country. And we're good at that, and we've got a good bus sector, so we need to keep that going in terms of our transport spend, including especially versus rail. You might get more money from buses.
Michael.
Thanks very much, Convener. Very quickly, I should have said this earlier, the committee knows that Scotland's health is poor. We have low and falling life expectancy. We have widening health inequalities. It's 10 years gap between the most prosperous areas and the poorest for women. It's 14 years for men. We know that there's a risk that that situation will get worse. Our modelling shows if we do nothing, the forecast burden of disease is going to increase by 21% by 2043. But hopefully, Convener, that is not inevitable. Change is possible, as I've said, by prioritising investment in primary prevention and also thinking about how support public spending to be most effective. As Calder says, outcome budgeting and multi-year D is a key part of that. One of the things we've not talked about, Convener, which I think might be helpful, is to think of the lens of place when we come about how public money is spent. For me, that's about where power resides. Could we take an asset-based approach? Could we trust communities in the third sector over the longer term, exactly in the way that Adam's described that what happened in practice in COVID? So thinking of that lens of place when thinking about budgeting, it might be another helpful addition for the committee. Thanks, Convener.
Ruth.
I think, first of all, that we would reiterate the comments that are made every time we get to budget scrutiny around the importance of transparency, the changes to allow us to look at how spending is changing over years, doing year-on-year comparison. All of that is really important. But I would urge the committee, as you take forward your pre-budget scrutiny, to think about ensuring that you continue to place that emphasis on poverty. We know that 21% of our population lives in poverty. That rises to 24% for children. And I think it's easy to become numb to those statistics, but actually we know that that has far-reaching negative consequences for people's lives. During the cost of living crisis, we've heard from women that are going without food themselves in order to feed their children. We've seen the impact of poverty in the recent statistics around suicide deaths, around alcohol-related deaths, and also child homelessness. We know that people in Scotland believe in justice and compassion, and we really want to see those shared values being turned into concrete action to tackle poverty. So we have cross-party support for those child poverty targets, and it's vital that we meet them and that those are not sacrificed. And also, in the longer term, tackling poverty and inequality is good for economic growth. And that's not just organisations that are in the anti-poverty sector or the equality sector that say that. That also comes from institutions like the IMF. I think in this climate, the spending that we've all called for today necessitates us to look at our tax system and how Scotland can use their powers progressively. Our paper sets out a range of options, and I think what we really want to come from the publication of that paper is that we see a serious conversation about how we could take forward some of those options.
Okay, thank you. Alistair.
I think if we are really going to address the medium long-term sustainability of Scotland's finances, we need to invest resources where they will drive inclusive and green economic growth. Where they will improve the productivity of the Scottish economy and where it can actually drive demographic growth, because that was one of the challenges coming out really strongly from the first session. I don't think we need to accept economic constraints and demographic constraints as a given. I think we can grow the economy, we can grow productivity, we can attract talent and investment to Scotland. Obviously, from my point of view, I see universities as a crucial part of that, but I think it's wider than that. So please, let's focus on investment, where we can get that, you know, broad return on investment to create a more prosperous and inclusive society.
Okay, thank you. Philip, and then It'll be yourself, Adam.
So I think similar, as I said before, you know, if your starting point is 1 billion and your end point minus 1.9 billion, that's what we need to start centering all of this thinking around. I think, you know, I absolutely, it's in our evidence, cannot get away from the fact that tax is going to need to play a big part. So that's both looking again at income tax, the whole system, but also then looking again at local and wealth taxes, albeit recognising that there are absolutely legitimate concerns around unintended consequences and diminishing returns, which are very real. So if you accept the tax has to do some of the heavy lifting but can't do it all, I think, as other colleagues had said, and I would just reiterate, that requires prioritisation and I think responsibility on this, and actually more importantly all the subject committees, to be genuinely interrogating, are the things in this budget going to shift the curve on those big priorities, and do we have the evidence to prove it? So the prioritisation, and then similar to Michael, prevention. Like, we cannot continue to discuss Christie as though it's some kind of long-term ambition. The long-term ambition was set more than a decade ago, and we need to start doing something about it and start to fundamentally shift our spending. We are spending billions of pounds every year and losing from the economy billions of pounds every year, responding to the consequences of not having addressed prevention before now. We really need to start shifting the balance of our spend.
Agrees, but no one tells us what we should be disinvesting in. That's a problem. Adam.
Well, I think part of this is we've got our demographic changes and where we need investment, of course, but also it goes again to Alistair Sim's point about investing in things that will maybe generate income, and looking at fair work and looking at how we support an ageing population to work more if they can, to maybe work a little bit, to bring more people who are no longer in the workforce, and then create an age-inclusive workplace across Scotland, protecting the public sector or those that are contracted by the public sector. I think we can actually find more people generating income for the country financially, but also setting themselves up better for the future, so they might not require as much either health spend or indeed social security spend in the future. So actually how you can think about drawing down some money by helping more people in the medium and long term back into work to do and do something about that. But with the ageism that they have in our society, it makes it awfully hard to do. But where we can start again, if we used to face low-hanging fruit before, is what the levers can the government and public sector do to make sure that older workers are supported throughout their life, but also opportunities to get back into work when they can, particularly if they find themselves no longer in a caring role or as much of a caring role, because we've got folks that will, who are contributing so much, not financially, to the country. You know, 30-odd billion pounds worth of care is delivered in an unpaid sector, but imagine what would happen if they weren't doing that anymore. So we've got a really fine balance there. So I think supporting an ageing population to be able to contribute more financially through longer their life is really important to do as well.
Okay, if we had more time, I'd talk to you about the taxation of occupational pension
thing.
Very quick then.
You know, you are absolutely fairly, you know, we come here and demand money, so you absolutely fairly kind of expect us to say where money can be saved as well. I suppose a bit of a plea, and not to anyone in this room necessarily, that actually I suppose the opposite applies onto the political side as well. So you talk about prevention, I think actually Michael kind of mentioned it, but I don't want to put words in your mouth. You take health, for example. You can start shifting secondary care, continues to dominate the system and attention and funding, but actually you get some of your greatest returns in primary care. You can start shifting your spend from secondary into primary for some really big outcomes, but I could imagine the political bun fight that arises as a result of that. So I suppose it's much of a plea, actually, that, you know, on our side, we need to be realistic. I suppose equally a bit of a plea on the political side that I think we just need to get to a position to be able to have that grown-up debate about actually where is our money best spent and what kind of return does it deliver.
Okay, thanks very much. I want to thank all our guests. I'm going to call a two-minute break in order for the official report on our guests to leave, and then we're going to have a very short five-minute private session. We're going to put most of our private work programme to one side and just discuss two issues very quickly with the committee, seeing as time is marching.